from the pre-registration, I'm sure there's some stragglers that'll come in, but I'd like to go ahead and get started on time for several reasons. First of all, is we've been fortunate to have this program qualified for continuing legal education by the state of North Carolina, so I like to play by their rules and commence on time, so forth. Secondly, we're very honored today to have the Dean of the Law School here to greet all of you, so I'm going to turn it over at this time to Dean Kate Bartley.
Actually, we always start on time at Duke Law School, so this is easy. I want to welcome all of you, some perhaps new to Duke Law School, and I see many familiar faces, to this third annual Robbins and Everett Conference on White-Collar Crime. Many of you are here probably already knowing Robbins and Everett and the fact that he is one of our most distinguished and the longest-serving member of this faculty. I believe that's true, although every now and then George Christie tries to tangle with him on that issue. But really a mainstay around here, a favorite in the classroom, and obviously a man of many expertises. One of the many things he's done for Duke Law School is to bring us Walter Cox, who I believe may still hold the record for one of our favorite teachers at the law school. He hasn't been back for a little while, but a very, very popular classroom performer. And if you don't already know him, you'll probably see some of that today. Obviously, a very important topic, and one which I know virtually nothing about. So it's my great pleasure to introduce to you not a speaker, but someone you may rub elbows with if you come back to Duke, which I hope you will. He is our dean designate, Judge David Levy, who comes to us from as Chief Judge of the Eastern District of California. Previous to that, he was the U.S. Attorney in the Eastern District of California, a Stanford Law graduate, who was president of the Stanford Law Review. Also, the head of the Federal Rules Committee. How true would that be? I'm missing a word or two in there, but seems to rise to the top of whatever group he is a part of. Been described in many ways, including sometimes the smartest. Sometimes he's described as, I'm sure he always is, the smartest man in the room, or whatever you want. But anyway, it's a real pleasure for me to always to have the chance to introduce him. And he's not going to take up time on your program, but I thought Robbie invited him to say a couple of words to you today as kind of a joint welcome. Glad to have you here. If you need anything while you're here, need to know your way around, I think you'll find helpful people. And enjoy the conference, and I hope you come back. David.
Thank you very much. Let me just echo that welcome and to commend Professor Everett for pulling together this conference, or for having this conference in his honor. It's a very important topic, and it's one that I do care a great deal about. I was a prosecutor for 8 or 9 years. I was U.S. attorney. I spent hundreds of hours before the grand jury prosecuting white-collar crime cases, and of course, the importance of those cases has been elevated, it seems to me, in the last few years because of DOJ policies, which have made quite an impact on corporate America. So conferences like this are very important and very well attended across the country. I'd like to make you aware of one of the rules proposals that is out for the public comment period just closed, but the Evidence Rules Committee is considering a new evidence rule 502 that would provide for selective waiver. I don't know whether this is a topic that is on your agenda, although it may be. This would permit a company to waive the attorney-client privilege in dealing with regulatory agencies, but retain the privilege for all other purposes. I don't know what the evidence committee is going to do with the proposal, but you might be thinking about it today because it's one of the central topics. And if you have any particular wisdom on it, even though the public comment period is closed, I'd be happy to hear from you. That's permitted under our rules. Well, have a very good conference and welcome.
Welcome to Duke. Jelly cell mix. Put them on the dashboard. where the cell phone safely sit on there. So please have one from Nelson Mullin. Hey, thank you for your time.
What?
That was a pleasure having the dean and the dean designee with us today. Thank you, Robinson, for arranging that. That was something on my agenda that Doris Ann Kelly, who's helping us administer this, and I had talked about a few days ago, and I completely forgot to do what I was supposed to do, so thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Walter Cox. I'm a partner with Nelson Mullins, Riley, and Scarborough. It's a law firm. It's located in South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia. We have a small office, a two- or three-person office in Boston, and a growing office in Washington, D.C. My affiliation with Duke is through Robinson O. Everett. He and I served together on what is now called the United States Court of Appeals for the Armed Forces. We served together beginning in 1984 and have continued our association over these last, 23 years now. It's hard to believe it's been that long. In 1999, he was kind enough to arrange for me to come to Duke and co-lecture in criminal law. I then graduated into holding some seminars and teaching ethics and a few other things at Duke along the way. So I got to know the dean and the faculty here and just think the world of this particular place. When I joined Nelson Mullins, one of the things I wanted to do was to host a seminar on white-collar crime and name it in honor of my friend and colleague, Robinson O. Everett. And so that is the genesis of this particular conference. We have a wonderful program today. I'll introduce our first speaker. Did you have a chance to sign the waiver? Thank you, sir. You know, this is big time production here at Duke. This is on a webcast and on a DVD or whatever. And so we have to waive our rights. You know, they can sell our souls, I guess. I don't know what Blue Devils do to people, but in any event, our first speaker is the Honorable Carl Horn. Judge Horn is a U.S. Magistrate Judge for the Western District of North Carolina. He's recognized among us criminal law practitioners as the Dean of Continuing Legal Education. He publishes and keeps current a book updating significant decisions in the Fourth Circuit and the United States Supreme Court. And today, he's going to bring that message to us. So, Judge Horn, I'll turn the program over to you.
You'll get one of these. I brought one for everybody here. Well, very good. Well, it's a great honor to be back at Duke, and particularly something in honor of Judge Everett, who I've become so fond of, and Judge Cox, who invited me to participate for this third annual presentation. I believe the handout you got, which is peach-colored, is that what you call that, coral or peach-colored, would be my paper, and I'm going to be referring to the pages, so you may want to find that. You'll see in that paper, on page 2, an explanation for what all those cross-references to the handbook are, and it's essentially the book that Judge Cox just mentioned, the Fourth Circuit Criminal Handbook, and specifically to the 2006 edition. I think the 2007 edition goes to press on Monday, and I think will be shipped sometime in early May. The next 7 pages of the handout there, the paper, are the table of contents of that book, which is also my best effort to construct an outline of federal criminal law. The 9 sections or chapters are, you'll see, search and seizure, confessions and other statements, miscellaneous pretrial issues, drug offenses, which we'll touch on only in a small way this today. Next, firearms offenses, which I don't think we'll touch on at all today. Then next would be miscellaneous issues, primarily Title 18 offenses and the order they appear in that title. Then a section on trial issues, next sentencing issues, and finally appeal and post-conviction issues. If any of those topics are covered in the paper, they'll be covered in the order they would appear in that table of contents. And the first case summary is on page 10.
several points about search and seizure issues relevant to the white-collar practice. The first case, U.S. versus Hurwitz. There, law enforcement first received information from arrested drug dealers identifying the defendant, a medical doctor, as their source. They also interviewed five of the doctor's former patients, which led to their conclusion that the doctor and defendant-to-be was not running a legitimate medical practice. They learned, for example, that drugs were prescribed with cursory or no examinations, that the doctor defendant charged cash initiation fees of $1,000 and then $250 also in cash per patient per month as maintenance fees thereafter. They learned that his medical license had been previously suspended for similar conduct in Virginia and the District of Columbia. They learned that he knew some of his patients were reselling the drugs he prescribed and that the quantities prescribed to a number of his individual patients were far in excess of what was considered acceptable medical practice. Now, armed with all this information, agents sought and obtained a search warrant which authorized the seizure of all of Dr. Hurwitz's patient medical and billing files. Dr. Hurwitz's essential argument was that the seizure of all of his files, based in part on statements of only five of his patients, was unconstitutionally overbroad. The Fourth Circuit disagreed, noting that there is much broader latitude in the permissible scope of search and seizure where a business is permeated with fraud, and they concluded that there was probable cause to believe that this was just such a business and found no error in the seizure of all of the doctor's files. The next section describing items to be seized in the warrant, the same case, Hurwitz, there the search warrant described the items to be seized by reference to an attachment to the application for the search warrant, but this was not left at the scene when the search warrant was executed. The defendant argued, based on the Supreme Court's 2004 decision in Groh versus Ramirez, that it was required both that the description in the attachment to the affidavit be incorporated by reference and attached to the search warrant in order for it to be constitutionally proper. The Fourth Circuit disagreed. A majority of the circuits agreed with the defendant's argument, and the Fourth Circuit joined only the Sixth Circuit, now becoming the Second Circuit, to state that under Groh versus Ramirez, it was either or, not both and. Next case, another and the final search and seizure case, a consent to search issue, U.S. versus Butner. There, I'm on page 11. There, law enforcement received complaints that online fraud was being committed using AOL and eBay accounts opened in the name of Michelle Butner, the defendant-to-be's wife. Responding to the complaints, police went to the Butner home where they found Michelle Butner present, but Mr. Butner not present, the computer on, and began to ask her about the suspect transactions. Mrs. Butner assured them that she knew very little about the computer, that she used it only to, quote, occasionally play solitaire, and invited them to have at it, and she was generally very cooperative. Well, pursuant to Mrs. Buckner's oral consent, the police seized the hard drive of the computer and took it in for forensic analysis. There they found that the complaints of fraud were confirmed by the documents, albeit not by Mrs. Butner, but by her husband, who was subsequently indicted on 20 counts of wire fraud and 12 counts of mail fraud. The issue on appeal was whether Mrs. Butner had actual or apparent authority to consent to the search of Mr. Buckner's password-protected files. The Fourth Circuit concluded that Mrs. Butner did not have actual authority to consent, but that she did have apparent authority. As noted on page 12 of your materials, the panel distinguished the case of Trulock versus Free, a 2001 Fourth Circuit decision in which the court held that a co-resident of a home and co-user of a computer who did not know the necessary password for her co-user's protected files did not have apparent or actual authority to consent to search of those files, likening the private computer in that case to a locked box within an area of common usage or authority. I have a query following that case summary, asking the question if instead of taking the hard drive in for forensic analysis and discovering the password-protected files under the husband defendant's password protection, if they had tried to get into it at the residence and had been told by Mrs. Butner that she didn't have the password, would the outcome have been different? And I think the answer to that is probably yes. All right, double jeopardy and rule the rule of lenity. U.S. versus Fitzgerald on page 12 of your materials. There, the defendant pled guilty to wire and mail fraud, but then failed to appear for sentencing. As a result, he was also indicted for that is for failing to appear for sentencing. At sentencing on that charge, the district judge determined that a three-level enhancement should be applied because the failure to appear offense occurred while the defendant was on release. The defendant objected, arguing that the failing to appear for sentencing was by its very nature always committed while on release, and therefore he was essentially being punished twice for the same conduct in violation of the Double Jeopardy Clause. In the alternative, he argued that the intended interaction of the two statutes and the sentencing guidelines was ambiguous, and therefore under the rule of lenity, the least harsh sentence should be imposed and must be imposed. The district judge disagreed, applying the enhancement for committing the second offense while on offense, and a divided Fourth Circuit panel, Judges Shedd and Williams in the majority, affirmed. The majority also concluded that the statutes and the sentencing guidelines were clear and unambiguous, and therefore that the rule of lenity would not apply. Judge King of West Virginia, the Fourth Circuit judge from West Virginia, one of them, filed a lengthy dissent in which he strenuously took issue with the majority on both points, concluding that the statute was indeed ambiguous and that, as he said, the defendant gets punished for failure to appear and then he gets punished again for failure to appear in violation of the Double Jeopardy Clause. Time has run out for a petition for rehearing en banc, so for the time being, that is the law in the Fourth Circuit. We have two decisions in 2006 involving drug distribution by a medical doctor. The first one, Hurwitz, we've spoken about a little bit already. There, the medical doctor was convicted of a drug trafficking conspiracy, one count of drug trafficking resulting in death, two counts of drug trafficking resulting in serious bodily injury, and 46 substantive drug trafficking counts. He was sentenced to 25 years in prison. We've already talked some about that evidence, but I think it's certainly clear that in the light most favorable to the government, there was much incriminatory evidence against the defendant. For example, one individual was prescribed 500,000 pills during the period in question. He had been identified by those arrested on drug charges in three different states, Virginia, Tennessee, and West Virginia, as their drug source. But on the other hand, the defendant, Dr. Hurwitz, did not go gently into that good night, mounting a defense centered around his good faith belief that his prescription practices were medically appropriate. To establish this defense, he put on expert testimony and called as witnesses former patients and members of his staff. More than one patient testified at the trial that Dr. Hurwitz was the first doctor to provide real relief from his or her chronic pain, and former members of his staff testified uniformly that he was a caring and compassionate medical professional. The primary issue on appeal, in addition to the search and seizure questions we've already gone over, was whether a doctor's good faith belief that he was acting within the bounds of accepted medical practice was a legitimate defense, and if so, the proper parameters of a jury instruction to that effect. The Fourth Circuit concluded that a doctor's good faith generally is relevant to a jury's determination of whether the doctor acted outside the bounds of medical practice or with a legitimate medical purpose. However, the court emphasized that the jury should be instructed that to be a defense, the good faith must be objective and reasonable. That is, it must be more than just the doctor's subjective belief that what he or she was doing was reasonable. Applying these principles in Hurwitz, the Fourth Circuit held first that the good faith instruction requested by Dr. Hurwitz was an incorrect statement of the law, that is, that it was insufficiently connected to any objective standard or limited by reasonableness, and therefore the district judge had properly declined to give that instruction. However, and this might surprise you, the district judge's equally erroneous instruction that the doctor's good faith belief about his professional conduct, which was the heart of his defense, was irrelevant, was reversible error. So Dr. Hurwitz will get a new trial. In the second case, U.S. versus McIver, the defendant was a doctor of osteopathic medicine who, like Dr. Hurwitz, specialized in pain management. He operated out of a medical clinic in Greenwood, South Carolina, where he prescribed, as the opinion states it, massive quantities of oxycodone, Dilaudid, Oxycontin, methadone, and morphine to, again, this is quoting the opinion, to patients who included admitted drug addicts who traveled significant distances to see him, appeared without referrals, paid in cash, and sought specific drugs which were prescribed for them based on little or no physical examination. The defendant was indicted on 15 counts and convicted of 8, including 2 counts charging the unlawful distribution of a controlled substance resulting in one of his patients' death. En route to affirming, in that case, the defendant's convictions and his 30-year sentence, the Fourth Circuit made several noteworthy points. First of all, the court succinctly restated again the elements of a violation of this statute, that is, the distribution of drugs by a medical doctor, the third of which is that the drugs were distributed outside the usual course of professional practice. Second, the panel addressed the jury instruction on that third element. The defendant argued essentially that the instruction confused the criminal standard of liability with the medical malpractice civil standard, and that was reversible error. The instruction, the lengthy instruction on that third element, again, whether the distribution was outside standard medical practice, is included in its entirety in a footnote in the opinion. The court in this case found that instruction adequate and a correct statement of the law. And the third point that the court made in that case, McIver, in affirming the defendant's conviction for conspiring with his patients, some of whom were distributing rather than taking the drugs, the Fourth Circuit noted that the government could prove the doctor's knowledge that this was going on, either by showing and proving his actual knowledge or by showing willful blindness to what was going on in which he was complicit. There is one environmental crime case reported, and another one I'll just mention to you. Published Wednesday of this week, and I just got around to reading this morning. It's not in your materials, but the one that is U.S. versus Hillier. We're on page 15 of the materials. In Hillier, the defendant was the manager of a major bridge construction project between the mainland and our Outer Banks. Following what all agreed was a commendable job, during the final weeks of the project, the defendant instructed employees to dump fill material and to use dredging techniques in order to finish on time, which were in violation of federal law. The defendant, after two of his employees pled guilty and agreed to cooperate, himself pled guilty to violation of two statutes, the Rivers and Harbors Act of 1899 and the Clean Water Act. At sentencing, the district judge correctly found that the advisory sentencing guidelines range was 12 to 18 months imprisonment, but based on a departure under one of the sections of the guidelines for aberrant behavior, imposing instead a probationary sentence, 3 years probation. The Fourth Circuit reversed, finding the departure for aberrant behavior unreasonable under Booker. We'll talk about Booker a little bit more in a few minutes. The court noted that departures for aberrant behavior are only proper where a defendant committed a single criminal act or occurrence, or were engaged in a single criminal transaction that was, one, committed without significant planning, two, was of limited duration, and three, represented a marked deviation by the defendant from an otherwise law-abiding life. In contrast, the court said here, the defendant, construction manager's conduct, quoting the opinion, constituted multiple criminal acts with each occurrence representing a violation, required considerable planning, and was not of limited duration. That is, the criminal conduct persisted for roughly 10 days. The Fourth Circuit also found it error for the district court to consider in support of a downward departure the defendant's age, prior payment by the company of substantial restitution, and the fact that there was a lack of permanent environmental harm. Well, you know, when I read that, I thought it was, you know, so much for the theory that the sentencing guidelines are advisory and that the review on appeal is just for reasonableness. The other environmental case not in your materials is U.S. versus Cooper. It was decided Wednesday, the 28th of March, and it is a fairly lengthy opinion, and it decides an issue of first impression. There, the defendant ran a little place for trailers, a little trailer community, where 22 mobile home trailers dumped their sewage into a lagoon. The lagoon was fairly primitive and ultimately spilled over, and after some very rudimentary chlorination, was passed off into a little creek, which became a larger stream, which became the Roanoke River, which spilled into the Albemarle Sound. And therefore, as the argument was made, implicated federal jurisdiction. It was made successfully. And in fact, that was not the issue in the case. You'll know that you'll remember that the jurisdiction, federal jurisdiction, is based on waters of the United States being affected by the polluting act. And the law, it's clear that any little tributary, which ultimately ends up in a body of water, which is a navigable body of water, which almost every trickling stream does, is a water of the United States. Again, that wasn't the issue. What the issue, the discrete issue here, first impression, I think there are only four circuits that have spoken to it, was does the government have to prove that the defendant knew that these were waters of the United States? Not that they were, but that they knew it. And the court held no. All that the government has to prove in terms of mens rea or knowledge is that he or she knew that the pollution was, that they were polluting, and that the water, that it was entering water of some sort. And there was a lot, abundant evidence of that fact. And so the defendant's conviction and sentence was affirmed. But it's a long, interesting opinion. Next section, page 16 of the materials, identity theft. In that case, United States versus Montejo, the defendant pled guilty to immigration and Social Security fraud, but not guilty to identity theft in violation of a statute which carries a two-year consecutive term of imprisonment. The sole basis for the defendant's defense was that while he knew the identification documents, including an alien registration and Social Security card with numbers on them, were fraudulent, that is, that they were not his numbers, he did not know that the numbers actually belonged to someone else. Hence, he argued he had not knowingly committed identity theft. Construing the statute for the first time, the Fourth Circuit concluded, sort of like the environmental case, that the word knowingly refers to the verbs, that is, knowingly transfers, possesses, or uses, not necessarily, and it's not necessary to prove that a defendant knew the numbers had been assigned to an individual in order to convict them of identity theft. The court cited a drug case where an individual is subject to a higher penalty if they receive drugs from someone under the age of 18. It's not necessary to prove a conviction under that statute to show that the person who received the drugs knew the individual was under the age of 18, just that they knew they were engaging in a drug transaction and that the person in fact was under the age of 18. Next case on 17, defining reasonable doubt. There, U.S. versus Smith, the defense counsel was on his fourth definition of reasonable doubt in his closing argument when District Judge Raymond Jackson of Virginia got impatient, stopped him, and said, "I hate to interrupt you." I think he told a lie, but he said, "I hate to interrupt you, but not even the court is permitted to define reasonable doubt in the Fourth Circuit for the jury, so respectfully do not attempt to define it for them." And then proceeded in the instruction to the jury to say that same thing again and tell them basically that any attempt to define reasonable doubt leads to more confusion, and that they're not bound to accept counsel's definition in any event of reasonable doubt, which had been a fairly significant part of his closing argument. The defendant argued on appeal that the court abused its discretion in interrupting him and in so instructing the jury. The Fourth Circuit said no, and again articulated the well-known principle that the court may not or should not define reasonable doubt, and in fact, even when asked to define reasonable doubt by a jury, does not abuse its discretion in declining to do so. Now, the next four or five pages of your materials deal with what is a pretty complex subject, I think, post-Booker sentencing and review on appeal. The Supreme Court just issued its fourth major decision this year, 07, in Cunningham versus California, defining sort of the new sentencing jurisprudence, at least from the Supreme Court. But before we talk about that case a little bit, let's just review in our minds the three cases that led up to that: Apprendi versus New Jersey, Blakely versus Washington, and U.S. versus Booker. Those of you who do much federal work will remember that in Apprendi, the defendant was convicted of possessing a firearm for an unlawful purpose, a crime which was punishable by 5 to 10 years imprisonment. However, based on a judicial finding that the possession was in connection with a hate crime, which is punishable under New Jersey law by 10 to 20 years imprisonment, the state judge imposed a 12-year term of imprisonment. The Supreme Court vacated that sentence, reasoning that the Sixth Amendment requires any fact that increases the penalty for a crime beyond the prescribed statutory maximum other than the fact of a prior conviction to be submitted to the jury and proven beyond a reasonable doubt. In the second case in that triumvirate of Supreme Court jurisprudence, Blakely, there the defendant was convicted in Washington State of second-degree kidnapping with a firearm, a crime which subjected him to a sentence of between 49 and 53 months imprisonment. At sentencing, however, the judge went on to find that the defendant had acted with deliberate cruelty, and the facts real quickly were the mother of a child in front of the mother by the father was stuffed into a box, as I recall, in the back of a truck, and talk in front of the child about killing the mother, terribly traumatic. So the judge concluded this showed deliberate cruelty and imposed an enhanced sentence under the statute of 90 months imprisonment. But again, the Supreme Court reversed, finding a Sixth Amendment violation and vacating the sentence. Thirdly, in Booker, that's where the defendant was sentenced based on a higher drug quantity than that found by the jury. The Supreme Court ended our speculation about whether Apprendi and Blakely applied to the United States sentencing guidelines, squarely holding that they did. Rather than striking down the entire federal sentencing scheme, however, as being unconstitutional, the Supreme Court in Booker, in two different 5-4 decisions, held, first of all, that the sentencing guidelines would henceforth be understood to be advisory rather than mandatory, and secondly, that on appeal, the courts of appeal would only review a district judge or district court sentence for reasonableness. So back to Cunningham, the 2007 decision. There the defendant was convicted of continuous sexual abuse of a child under the age of 14, which under California's determinate sentencing law carried a 12-year term unless the judge finds one or more aggravating factors. In this case, the judge found there were six aggravating factors, including the particular vulnerability of the victim in this case and the defendant's violent conduct, and imposed a 16-year term of imprisonment. In an opinion written by infrequent bedfellows, or joined by infrequent bedfellows on the Supreme Court, written by Justice Ginsburg, joined by Chief Justice Roberts, Justice Stevens, Justice Scalia, Justice Souter, and Justice Thomas. I bet there's not another opinion ever written that, of course, Justice Roberts has not been on the court long enough, but excluding him, where all those justices have agreed. But they found another clear Sixth Amendment violation and vacated the sentence in that California case. All right. We're on page 19 of your materials. And I was glad to see this. My perception in the Fourth Circuit is the Fourth Circuit has been quick to reverse any sentence where there's been a downward variance or downward departure as being unreasonable, but far more likely to uphold an upward departure or higher sentence as being reasonable. But here, in 2006, we have three decisions which reversed upward departures as unreasonable after Booker. First of those, on page 19, U.S. versus Guyon. There, the defendant pled guilty to several fraud offenses, and the then mandatory sentencing guidelines established a sentencing range of 140 to 175 months. The offenses of conviction involved the defendant's introducing himself to a woman at a Kinko's store under a false name and identity, dating and quickly convincing this woman that he loved her, then proceeding to steal her assets and her identity in various ways. By the time the woman realized what was going on, she was out over $170,000. She's referred to as the Kinko's victim in the opinion. As it turns out, she was the latest in a series of victims of similar schemes concocted by this defendant. So at sentencing, the government moved for an upward departure, arguing that the guidelines range did not adequately reflect the extent of the defendant's criminal history, the similarity of his past offenses or transgressions, and the current offenses, and the likelihood that he would be a recidivist. District Judge Terry Boyle in the Eastern District of North Carolina agreed, imposing a 180-month sentence, which, as you'll note, is only 5 months above the top of the advisory guidelines range, which was 175 months. But nevertheless, the defendant successfully argued on appeal that the judicial fact-finding in this case under a then-mandatory guidelines scheme violated Booker. The second decision, on page 20, U.S. versus Tucker, there, the defendant had two prior fraud convictions and was on supervised release for one of them when she pled guilty to a single count of bank fraud. As it turned out, a portion of the $77,000 out of which she defrauded the bank in this case had been used to pay restitution in connection with the first two convictions. Well, at sentencing, a district judge, Judge Herlong in Greenville, South Carolina, was unpersuaded by the defendant's primary argument for a within-guideline sentence, the guidelines in that case being 24 to 30 months. Her defense was that she suffered from major depression, which stemmed from childhood abuse. Rather than accepting that defense and imposing a within-guideline sentence, Judge Herlong stated on the record that he intended to fashion a sentence which will significantly keep her away from the public, and he described her as a dedicated thief who will apparently always be one. And he imposed a 12-year term of imprisonment, 144 months. Reviewing on appeal for reasonableness, the Fourth Circuit held first that some upward variance or departure was warranted for the reasons articulated by the district court, but that the extent of that departure, almost five times the upper end of the guidelines range, was unreasonable, reversing and vacating and remanding for resentencing. And the third upward departure case, on the bottom of page 20 in your materials, Dalton, There, the defendant pled guilty to credit card fraud, which resulted in approximately $100,000 in loss. The pre-sentence report calculated 15 criminal history points, which put the defendant in criminal history category 6, the highest, and came up with a sentencing guidelines advisory range of 46 to 57 months. At sentencing, District Judge David Norton of South Carolina found that the defendant had 23 potential criminal history points in addition to the 15 points that were reported in the pre-sentence report. He also determined that the criminal history category of 6 would not adequately reflect the past criminal conduct or the chances of recidivism and imposed an upward departure sentence of 105 months. In an opinion written by Judge Wilkinson and joined by Judges Motz and Gregory, the Fourth Circuit again agreed that some upward departure was reasonable, but concluded in light of the extent of the departure that the district court's failure to depart incrementally, that is, to look at the next one up and how does this do? Is that enough? Is that enough? Is that enough? But in light of the extent of the departure, that the sentence had to be vacated and remanded because it was unreasonable. Two decisions to report on restitution, one involving a special assessments issue. The first of those on page 21 of your materials, U.S. versus Davenport. There, the defendant pled guilty to a single count of credit card fraud. At sentencing, the district judge ordered the defendant to pay, based on a handout the government came with a list of similar conduct, they believe, the judge, Judge Quarles, ordered $8,000 in restitution, and the defendant had not been convicted of any of those transactions. The Fourth Circuit reversed, noting the absence of factual findings, but more significantly, that the court had plainly erred by ordering restitution to victims who were not victims of any offense of conviction. Note the difference in that outcome and the outcome in the next case, U.S. versus Roper, which was actually two appeals consolidated because they presented the same issue. There, the defendants were ordered to pay substantial restitution. Both violated their release, and upon the violation of release, the court remitted the restitution, deciding that it was impossible for the defendants to pay it. The government appealed, arguing that a district court lacks the authority to remit restitution for any offense under the Mandatory Victim Restitution Act, and the Fourth Circuit agreed. Fourth Circuit held that mandatory restitution must be ordered and may not subsequently be remitted with one narrow exception, and that is where there is a subsequent civil recovery, that is recovery in civil litigation by a victim of the offense. The court has the authority to remit restitution. Otherwise, on the government's motion or any motion, the court has no authority to do so. Now, the special assessment issue, obviously a much smaller amount of money. The court also remitted that. The court, Fourth Circuit said that was also improper. Only upon petition of the government can special assessments be remitted. And finally, one waiver of appeal decision, U.S. versus Cohen. There, the defendant pled guilty pursuant to a plea agreement which contained a waiver of appeal conviction to conspiracy to commit health care fraud. Specifically, the defendant agreed to waive all rights to appeal, quote, whatever sentence is imposed, including any issues that related to the establishment of the guidelines range, reserving only the right to appeal an upward departure. Despite the appeal waiver, the defendant filed an appeal which challenged District Judge Mack Howard's calculation of the loss amount and the restitution order, both the loss amount being $377,000 and change, and the restitution order being just slightly less than that. En route to finding the waiver of appeal valid in this case and therefore dismissing the appeal, the Fourth Circuit made four noteworthy points. First of all, they pointed out again that an appeal waiver will be enforced so long as it is knowingly, intelligently entered or waived, and secondly, the issue or issues fall within the scope of the waiver, that is, the issues that the defendant subsequently attempts to raise on appeal after having waived the right to appeal. The court rejected the defendant's main arguments that his waiver was not knowing and or intelligent due to his having ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and a related reading and writing disability, and or the government's unequal bargaining position. The court noted that the district court had inquired about the defendant's competency in general and his ADHD in particular. Various doctors who evaluated the defendant had found him competent, that his attorney had represented he had no difficulty communicating with the defendant, or that he had any doubt of his competency, and then the defendant's own statements on the record and under oath that he had read and understood the terms of his plea agreement. As to whether restitution was within the scope of the waiver, the Fourth Circuit pointed out that the law is well settled, that restitution is part of a criminal sentence, and so when an individual has one of those general waivers, which many U.S. attorneys' offices require as a condition of getting a plea agreement, they are waiving the right to appeal not only the term of imprisonment or the fine or the reasonableness under the guidelines, but also whatever amount is ordered in restitution. And the fourth point, as to the amount of restitution, and this is in contrast to the case where the judge ordered $8,000 in restitution based on a list handed up by the assistant U.S. attorney, but not related to the offense of conviction. Here in this case, the defendant sought to limit the amount of restitution by stipulating, it was a conspiracy charge, but stipulating only to certain overt acts in furtherance of the conspiracy, saying, I don't say I did this. You all know that you just have to prove one overt act in order to sustain a conspiracy conviction. He said, I'll admit this, I'll admit that, I don't admit any of the others, in fact, I deny the others, but he was still convicted of that conspiracy charge. Here, the court, again, upheld Judge Howard's restitution order because the offense of conviction was conspiracy, holding that it is proper for the district court to order restitution to all victims of a conspiracy, whether they admit or deny any particular overt acts in furtherance of that conspiracy. And those are the cases that touch on white-collar criminal issues 2006 through today. Oh, I haven't checked today. Through yesterday in the Supreme Court or in the Fourth Circuit. There are obviously many other decisions that might have analogous holdings, such as the drug decision about an under 18 recipient of drugs and whether the knowledge is necessary, and you could analogize that to a white-collar case. But those are the white-collar cases that I was able to find in my research. I have a few minutes left, and if there are any questions, we can entertain those, or we can. I know we have to leave some time between presentations for this recording. Anybody have any question, comment, or anybody involved in one of those cases we mentioned, the ones in the Eastern District or otherwise?
Judge, I have a question. Sure. And if this puts you on the spot, just say you're not going to answer it or anything. But
you wouldn't do that.
How, for this audience, how would you define, since you've been involved as both a prosecutor and as a judge, how would you describe the evolution of prosecution of white collar crimes from 10 or 15 years ago till today?
We have many more in federal court now.
Yeah.
We have many more prosecutors. We have some, and we never, when I was the chief assistant U.S. attorney from 1987 to 1993, we had no one who was specially designated as a white collar person or prosecutor. Today we have a number who are. They're smart, their career. In my day, we were not career. We served for a time, we went on, did something else. Their career, they're focused, they much more complex work, many more indictments. We have a lot of mortgage fraud, a lot of sophisticated national mail schemes that in some international. We have a big sweepstakes case that has was carried on in Costa Rica. The only Western district connection to it really was that Western Union routes its money through Charlotte. And so as they would get primarily older people to send the insurance to insure their sweepstakes winnings would make it to them, that money would be wired through Charlotte en route back to Costa Rica. So we have a couple of dozen defendants in that case, but it took a lot of national. We have lawyers from Boston, Washington, and agents and lawyers for the Justice Department, Atlanta and Florida, working that case together. So more national, complex investigations. I think it's even more so in places like the Southern District of New York and probably where Judge Levy practices in California. But yeah, much more sophisticated. Yes, sir.
Last year, the AARP magazine for retired old people like me.
I'm a member.
had an article about pain doctors that they requested the federal government campaign, as they call it, and the writer who wrote it happens to live in Durham. And AARP magazine had such a request for copies that they set up a special thing so that if you just called, they sent you sent $10, they sent you 6 or 7 copies. Are you familiar with that? Were you interviewed for it? Do you have any comments?
I wasn't interviewed for it, but I read it carefully on my Stairmaster one morning, and I thought it was fascinating. It was the cannabis. It was marijuana, specifically out in California, where medical marijuana.
The main part of it was about the thing I go through every month to renew the oxycodone prescription for my wife, which is where I've been this morning before I came here. And I just wanted to anyway, thank you so much.
I did not read that. I read the article about medical marijuana that was very interesting. Yes.
Carl, you mentioned a minute ago the case that you've got with the Costa Rican fraud. Came to mind, have you seen anything going on lately? This goes back to Panoia v. Neff, but where's the money when you're pursuing a debt or you're pursuing a conspiracy or a fraud charge? We don't ship money around the world anymore. It constitutes merely electronic transmissions blipping from anywhere to anywhere. And it has left some open questions with regards to, for example, a creditor who learns that somebody has deposited money in a bank that happens to be headquartered in Charlotte. And they go and they issue levy on the account in Charlotte. The money was deposited, could have been New Jersey, could have been anywhere, frankly. Have you seen anything or any discussion within the federal courts with regards to then proper venue and or jurisdiction relating to funds that the government wants to seize as perhaps illegal gains?
Not in the criminal context. The only thing close to that is the question about complete diversity in a civil case where you have substantial presences of banks in more than one place, but the headquarters is in another state, and the is there diversity of parties in that for civil federal purposes? But not in the criminal context, Tom.
If a bank operates in 20 states and the plaintiffs and defendants are, or either of them, are in any one of those states?
I think the case that I think decided that had the question was, what did it defeat diversity for there to be a substantial presence of an out-of-state bank in North Carolina and a North Carolina party or business going against that entity, and the law, as I recall, changed and allowed that case to go forward, that the presence in North Carolina did not defeat diversity. I believe that's the way that went. Any other questions, comments? Was anybody in this room involved in any of the cases that we mentioned, the Mack Howard case or the Terry Boyle case, the Outer Banks case? No. I'm sure some of your colleagues were. Well, thank you for having me. It's always great to be here.
I'm going to take a minute. These things are
our marketing department. You know, law firms have marketing departments. I never heard of anything like this. This is called a jelly cellmate. You just put it on your dash of your car or beside, you know, on the console, and it's got a substance on it where your BlackBerry will sit there and won't fly all over the place if you turn, that kind of thing. I know none of you use a cell phone in the car, so that's what you suggest.
Judge, I know you have a cell phone. I don't know if you know how to use it.
Good point.
I'll pass these out around the room.
We're going to need 5 minutes.
Okay. Start. And we'll take a 5 minute break while I pass these out to the next team.
We got 80 slides. The problem is getting through it, Judge, I think.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, if I may ask you to find your seat. Piece of the program of which you'll be eligible to receive 1 hour of ethics credit. It's being presented by a distinguished panel. However, two of our panelists have not made it. One of them called me, Mike Bryan, and begged forgiveness that he had an important corporate deal that fell through last week, and it reared its head again this week and was coming to fruition, and he just couldn't bail out on it. So I asked Alice if that was going to crimp the style of the panel. She said, oh no, we'll be able to cover Mike's stuff, no problem with that. And then Holly Pearson, who is one of my law partners who does white collar criminal work down in our Atlanta office, called me earlier and said she was flying in from Chicago and would be a little late for lunch, but so far she hasn't arrived from Chicago. So again, our remaining panelists are courageous and are going to go forward. And we even have a telephone set up that in case Holly links up by telephone. This modern technology carried to its ultimate. But let me take just a minute to introduce you to Josh Howard and to Alice Harris. Alice is a law partner of mine and Nelson Mullins, Riley, and Scarborough. She's in our Columbia, South Carolina office, and her practice focuses on health care. And as you heard from Judge Horn, a number of these white-collar offenses we find take place in the health care industry. There's just so much money in that industry, so many governmental programs that rely on the integrity of the physicians, so many opportunities for crime to take place, that it's an area that our law firm specializes in quite a bit. And Alice, who is in that healthcare business, is one of our practitioners in that arena. Our other panelist, Josh Howard, by the way, Alice presented to our symposium last year and was very well received.
Thank you.
And that's why I asked her to please come back. A couple of years ago, Josh appeared on our program with his father, Mac Howard, who recently has taken senior status as a federal district judge in the Eastern District of North Carolina. But Josh is a prosecutor. As you can see from his title up there, the Deputy Criminal Chief in the Eastern District of North Carolina, he focuses a lot of his energy and efforts on the preparing and prosecution of white-collar crimes. And he was very gracious to share Friday afternoon with us, and we're most appreciative. So I won't take any more of their time. I'll turn it over to you, Alice, and you, Josh, however y'all want to handle it.
Thank you, sir. Well, let us give you just for a moment a roadmap of what's ahead. Holly, who I suspect will call in at any minute, as she's often known to do. Any of y'all know Holly? Her force of personality is her calling card, and she has taken the lead in drawing up over 80 slides for us today. Most of it is centered around a hypothetical situation where, if any of you know her or practice in the Western District, I think you'll even recognize some of the composite names she's crafted. And it gives us an evolving set of facts that allows us to analyze issues from both civil and criminal perspectives, also from, you know, each side of the fence. I think on the front end, and maybe for the first hour, most of the narrative will be Alice's, and the second half will get much more into criminal liability. That'll probably be when I get more involved. And you know how to run the system, so I'll turn to you.
I do. I practice like Walter said in our Columbia office, and my practice is very much on the civil defense side. And I call people like Holly in to help me when the criminal aspects rear its head. And so, but I've learned enough about the criminal side along the years, because if you work doing internal investigations for a provider, since I do healthcare, it's usually for a large or small provider, you learn to recognize when you need to bring in a specialist in the criminal area. And so our slides are meant at the beginning, we'll start in through our fact pattern. If you have questions along the way, feel free to ask. We'll try to make it conversational up here at the extent we can, hoping that Holly can call in. We're ready for her, send her the phone number. But if not, we'll do the best we can, acting like four people today. So, Josh, you want, and these slides, it just goes forward. Let's see here. There we go.
The underlying hypothetical is about an entity known as Infotech, which is cast in under these facts as the largest supplier of IT in the United States. As you can see, and I won't read through every slide, but they realized through an internal audit that there were suspicious payments and potential bribes in connection with government contracts. And their general counsel, and the names become important as it goes on, so you can identify who's who. Here, Rob Newhouse consulted with outside counsel Peter Gibbons to begin an internal investigation. Through that investigation, they used questionnaires to all regional sales managers, and each questionnaire was accompanied by a cover letter from the CEO, who discussed the suspicious payments and emphasized the need for everybody to come clean. His letter indicated that he had requested that Newhouse conduct this internal investigation, as and consider the nature and legality, what the consequences were of the potential payments. Now, at this point, I'll turn to Alice, because this is before the criminal guys like me get involved. And the question that's posed first is, do you agree with the decision to conduct the internal investigation?
And, you know, I think anybody reading the hypothetical who's done any work in this area would probably agree that it is time to start digging further. You've got a routine audit that's been conducted, and they found what they think are suspicious payments. So it's time to start looking into it. But the decision on when to conduct an internal investigation is very fact-specific. But Holly and I, when we were looking over this, thought, absolutely, it's time to start an internal investigation. You've got what they think are suspicious payments in no less than two different states.
Now, that investigation was joint, again, between General Counsel Newhouse and the outside counsel, Gibbons. Is there anything about the joint nature of that that gives you pause?
Well, it, you know, I've read through a lot of literature on this and have been involved as mostly as outside counsel, but I've also worked with inside in-house counsel on that. A disadvantage of bringing in outside counsel is that it can get expensive. But barring that, I think what helps with, if you've got something of, especially of a larger nature or something that's going to involve a lot of people and perhaps step on toes, it's a good time to bring in outside counsel. It signals seriousness to the corporation. It signals that you have someone from the outside coming in. People look at you a little bit differently because as outside counsel, you're not viewed as a fellow employee. And also, it helps protect arguments of privilege. In-house counsel, you know, the court will scrutinize whether or not they were acting as an employee, someone who's doing business work versus legal work. So bringing in outside counsel often helps you protect future privilege arguments, although we'll talk a lot about privilege issues in the enforcement setting as we go along.
Well, what you just said gets us to the next two bullet points, really, which are, were the written questionnaires a good idea, and do they, in fact, at any point, because it was a joint investigation, become protected by either the attorney-client or work product privileges?
Well, and Holly and I were talking about this as well. I don't like the idea of the written questionnaires. Basically, you're sending it out to managers across the company, and then you're relying on those questionnaires for whether or not these suspicious payments were paid or not and the circumstances. And my fear in that is that you're sending it to maybe people who actually perpetrated the fraud. Let's say I'm sending it to five managers in Georgia, and I get one back that leads me there might be suspicious payments. Well, you know, I feel like I'm not doing my job unless we go into each of those settings a little bit more and see what was going on. But then if we had done them, one of the cases I think that all of you I'm sure are aware of, Upjohn versus United States. Whether they're protected or not, I think you go through the Upjohn factors. You know, were they sent by counsel? In this case, they were sent by the CEO, but on behalf of the counsel. The responses were sent back to counsel. The purpose was to help the firm obtain legal advice, and if the employee and if there was also instruction to keep the written questionnaires as confidential, I think at this point you have a good argument that they're covered by the privilege. But one of your touchstones, I think, is going back to Upjohn to see what the court went through in its analysis.
Now, let me go ahead at the outset here and say that we've got one panelist who has explained her reasons for why written questionnaires may not be such a great idea.
Right.
But if at any point, whether it's right on that point or the many to come, somebody out in the audience disagrees,
yeah,
that, you know, that's exactly what we're looking for. Feel free to raise your hand and pipe up on that point.
I know that Holly and I actually will come to somewhere. We and Josh and I also disagree on a couple of these items as we go forward. And I'll try to, if I remember where Holly and I disagreed, I'll let you know that. And I'll also try to give you the benefit of some of her comments.
We'll go ahead and pull these up, which is more into the hypothetical fact pattern. Based on the counsel's review of the completed questionnaires, they found at least three regional sales offices that had potentially messed up. Copies of those questionnaires were shared only with the board of directors and the CFO of the company, Slidell. Newhouse also provided all these individuals with a written summary of his conclusions with regard to the suspicious payments. That's going to be important, particularly in my half later in the presentation. And the legal conclusion in his memo was that the payments might be illegal, but that they could not be certain without further investigation. The questions that are raised then are, is Newhouse's written summary of his conclusions about the suspicious payments protected by either attorney-client or work product privileges?
Well, and I think at this point, Newhouse is our in-house counsel. At this point, I think it would be he's acting as a legal advisor to the corporation. Again, I think if it came into court, there would be a heavier scrutiny on whether it's protected or not because he is in-house counsel, and whether he's writing it with a legal hat or a business hat might make a big difference here. But I think at this point, it should be covered by the privilege.
Whether it's protected or not, is it a good idea?
Well, you know, I think Holly and I both agreed, and I'm not sure it was a good idea to put some of the conclusions in writing. Perhaps some of the conclusions related to the factual nature of the investigation, but terming anything, in my view, an early part of the investigation as illegal or fraudulent or that sort of thing in writing kind of bothers me, especially if you haven't finished your investigation yet.
One of the things you'll see later on in more of the criminal side of the presentation, there's been a fairly dramatic change in the last few months in DOJ policy about how much attorney-client or work product privileged information we can even have the audacity to ask for. And if we can get through what you'll see later is Category 2 protections, which are all internal practices and policies of the department, then you know whether or not you've put this in writing
right.
Suddenly comes into play. Mm-hmm. And so keep that flag in your mind for later on. Now, as a practical matter, and I forget what you and Holly said when we prepared, is that avoidable, and is it appropriate to distribute that to the board and the chief executive?
Well, I think it's avoidable. I think, you know, as an attorney, I want to keep track of it, and I want to write down at least the factual nature of it. And, you know, the mental conclusions, I think at that point everybody has a sense of what's going on. You certainly can discuss it with your client. You certainly can discuss it with your point person, which is sometimes in-house counsel. And I think at this point distribution to the board and the CFO is appropriate because, you know, if I'm remembering our facts correctly, I've come to the conclusion that these are possibly illegal and they're spread across several states. And so it's going to impact possibly impact the corporation in a serious way. So it may not be me. So often it's not me reporting directly to the board, to the CFO. It's the in-house counsel or my client contact.
Can I ask a question? You distributed to the board and the CFO, and I gather you not distributed to the CEO. That would seem a little incongruous to me.
Well, I think I'm reporting to the CEO, I think. So I think, is that...
Who is your client?
My client is the corporation.
And who is the corporation? The board of directors or the shareholders?
Well, you know, when I'm working in a hospital setting, I'm usually reporting to the in-house counsel and communicating with the CFO and CEO, and we're also communicating with the board of directors. So I view my client as, you know, the entity. And then I look at the upper level management as people that need to know the information. And so Mike Bryan could talk more about exactly, which parts of it are the be all end all as from a corporate perspective. But I view all at a high level investigation, my clients look to the board particularly as needing to know at a certain point like now. Does anybody else have any, from maybe has a deeper corporate perspective on that? At this point, I usually see in-house counsel, CEO, CFO, and the board being informed of what's going on.
Are these for-profit entities or not for-profit entities?
I think the hypothetical begins that Infotech is the largest IT company in the U.S., and I think it's safe to assume for the purposes of this discussion that it is very much for profit. And I think it's also safe to assume for the purpose of Judge Everett's question, unless you recall something different as the fact pattern evolves, that the CEO also has access to the legal conclusions that,
right,
that we had just talked
right.
about.
I think that's who this counsel is reporting to right now. It's working with in-house counsel, reporting to the CEO, and the question was, do we go beyond that? And I think so. But, you know, I think so.
The hypothetical evolves that the two counsel conducted interviews of employees at the suspected sales offices, which were three in number, and they jointly conducted the interviews. They both took copious personal notes, and they began each session by giving the interviewed employee what Holly has characterized, she's a former prosecutor, as a Miranda warning. Maybe some of y'all who do this work more commonly can come up with another term. But Alice, walk us through what you would tell somebody in that situation as either in-house or outside counsel.
Okay, well, what's interesting, read through the Miranda that these people end up giving to their employees, that they represent Infotech related to some suspicious payments. We do not represent you personally, which is good, but that because Infotech is our client and you are an employee, your communication and our communications to you during this will be privileged. And they go further and say that, you know, we maintain this, our confidences, and we take that responsibility very seriously. Do you understand? So if you look through and see how this is phrased, and then I'm going to talk in a second. I'll put up the next discussion questions. Yeah.
You know, there was a case recently where this exact message was given.
Right.
And, of course, the attorney-client privilege is the company's.
Right.
And the individuals,
rightly
or wrongly, had come to the conclusion, wrongly, that they were also being represented by the lawyers. The company decided to waive the privilege and essentially gave up the employees.
Right.
And so, really, that I would say that advice to the employees or that spill to the employees was misleading from the employees' perspective. They really didn't have any protection if the company decided to say, you know, give it up.
Yeah, and I agree. This is actually going to get the company a lot of trouble in a couple of slides. And I'm going to go through this is all called the corporate Miranda by some people. It's called the Upjohn warning. And the one I had before is not the way to do it. That's the do not do the one that was just up there.
If I could jump in there too. I mean, to the extent that we can presume right now that the company is predisposed at some point to work with the government, while this to some extent is far afield from my concern, and as a prosecutor, you probably don't even know about this case yet as it's going on, a jury has a remarkable capacity not to believe a confession. I recently had a trial where a guy confessed four times, and they only convicted on three counts, which may say more about the prosecutor than it did about the case. But what it amounts to is if you convince a jury as a criminal defense lawyer that there was something so hostile or wrong in the environment, regardless if it's a federal agent or an in-house or outside counsel, they may just entirely discount the value of that statement. And that so if you mess this up on the in-house side early on, it may not be of much value to the Justice Department later either. And so it's really not something to gloss over. It's something to, you know, to research extensively, you know, beforehand and get right if you have the ambition of using these materials to turn over to DOJ later as goodwill towards, you know, maybe avoiding corporate charges.
Yeah, I agree completely. I mean, I actually, when I walk into an interview, I carry my version of the corporate Miranda with me, so I don't forget to go through the different points. Judge, I think the case you were talking about may be NRA grand jury subpoena under seal, 415 F3rd 333, I think. They gave a version of Miranda. It was a little better than this one, and the court ended up saying that the employee's belief that they were represented by the counsel was not reasonable. Their Miranda was basically, we represent the company. These conversations are private, but the privilege belongs to the company, and the company decides whether to waive it or not. And there's another case, I don't have it in front of me, that I saw recently, and I can't remember the site for it, but if I find it later, I'll let everybody know. Similar thing, I think it got closer to the point where, because the attorney ended up saying something like, we can represent you, or maybe in the future if we don't have a conflict, we can represent you. So it got closer to the point where the court might have gone towards protecting the information discussed and during that interview from disclosure. But it's called, this is the corporate Miranda or the Upjohn warning, and it stems from the Upjohn case that extended the privilege to lower level employees with information. Definitely you want to say who the attorney represents. You represent the corporation, not the person being interviewed. The purpose of the interview is for the attorney to assist the corporation in providing legal advice to the corporation.
And this is what you would recommend?
This is what I'd recommend.
As an improved warning?
Yeah, as an improved warning. And there are quite a few nice articles that are easily accessible on the internet about this, and law review articles as well. It's a surprisingly, or not surprisingly, discussed a topic both on the internet and in law reviews. And whether the interview is privileged, and of course, who holds the privilege? The corporation holds the privilege, and that the corporation may decide later to waive the privilege and reveal what is said during the discussion. But also ask the employee for the need for confidentiality in order to protect the corporation's privilege.
What do you view the purpose of the Upjohn or the Miranda warning? I mean, why would you do it?
Well, it's actually, you know, one of the things also to do is make sure that the person you're interviewing understands this, because you don't want to give the impression to that person that you represent them, which might cause them to be misled. There may be a reason for that person to think they may need counsel themselves. We'll talk about some ethical rules soon. Depending on the situation, you may want to include the fact that the person that you're interviewing may want to consider getting counsel themselves. There's an ethical obligation that will arise during these slides that we'll talk about. And so the purpose is to make crystal clear to that person that you're not representing them, and also, you know, for confidentiality purposes, that, you know, this is a privileged conversation, but you will be telling the corporation what you've discussed, and that it's the corporation's privilege. It helps dispel any illusions that the employee may have.
And I think all those answers and explanations you've given just now answers the fourth bullet point on the next slide, which is, and what are the failings of the Miranda warning? And that's a curious name for it that is given in this hypothetical. So let's skip that one, and I'll just ask you very quickly, you know, what concerns would you have about the attorneys taking notes? And, you know, what on earth would they do otherwise?
Well, see, I'm a note taker. And so I take notes so I can, I know I've got some grimaces in the audience already, but I do take notes. I need to, so I can remember. Some investigations I talked to, you know, 50 people, and I don't have, you know, I need to remember who I talked to. Try to avoid characterizations and take it down. I do always have someone else in the room with me. We talk about the first question is, was the staffing of the interviews optimal? We talk through different, you know, we've got the in-house counsel there. Again, with in-house counsel, Holly and I discussed the fact that may not be optimal because of the possible question about whether or not that person, his communications or his notes are covered by the attorney-client privilege. I think in this setting, that person, sorry, I can't wait for you to be your turn. You know, I think in this setting, obviously this person is acting as a legal advisor, but one reason to have outside counsel there, either with a paralegal or another attorney in there to help take notes, is to make sure you get accurate information. But if the outside counsel's in there, I've seen it where people felt actually freer to talk to outside counsel than counsel that was part of the corporation for some reason in some circumstances.
What dynamic happens there? They think that?
Well, because they're talking to someone who is outside of it a little bit, who is not in the position as a fellow employee.
Mm-hmm.
It also signals a real seriousness of it. If the corporation, in my case, usually hospitals or large providers, have actually gone to the extent of bringing in outside counsel, it signals a real seriousness in it, and they tend to want to tell you everything. So, Holly said that she sometimes brings in investigators with her, and I have not actually ever done that, but she says she sometimes brings in an investigator. So I can't talk about the pros and cons of going that far. Maybe some of you have done that. I usually bring in either a paraprofessional or an associate who can help me make sure that I'm understanding information accurately, because I'm forming mental conclusions on that I may not be putting in my notes, and it's very helpful to have someone else there, and also as a witness.
Let's let the hypothetical evolve. Newhouse and Gibbons, the counsel's interview, Milton Wadhams, a software technician from one of the sales offices, and during the interviews, he gives all the telltale signs that he's been up to something. He assures them, or they assure him, that there's nothing to be nervous about, just tell the truth. And he explains the psychological abuse he has suffered from the sales office manager in his region, and that because of the abuse, he has sworn to ruin that guy's life. Now, at this point in the interview, Wadhams pauses and goes through one of those exchanges that I think you've been foreshadowing, and asks, is it really okay for me to talk about this with you? And Gibbons assures him that it is. And then he begins to explain his plan to ruin the life of the sales office manager. Wadhams tells them that he has forged the manager's signature on several large checks made payable to high-profile government officials in Florida and Georgia. And to the employee's chagrin, the officials kept the money and assisted that Southern Regional Office in obtaining substantial business contracts. The questions for discussion, Alice, are do the attorneys have an ethical obligation to stop the Wadhams interview as a result of any of their interactions with him, and what, if any, additional legal warnings should they have given him?
Well, this is a portion where we're going to start going through some ethical rules. I'm licensed in South Carolina, and so although you'll see references to the ABA model rule, the South Carolina rules are the same on this. I've gone through all this, and so to those of you who might be licensed in South Carolina, I've got copies of our rules, and they're the same. They're actually the same as the model rules, and I think that the North Carolina rules are the same as well.
They are, and here is that ABA model rule on point.
Yeah, and this actually explains, answers both of the questions for you. At some point, if you believe that the corporation's interest is becoming adverse to the employees, I think you have a legal obligation, an ethical obligation, to stop the interview and to sort of explain where you are. So if you have not already said, you can, you have the right to obtain independent counsel, and now is a good time. But let's go through the model rule, which we just had.
Here we go.
A lawyer shall explain identity of the client, and I think it's a good practice to do that anyways at the beginning. This says when the lawyer knows or reasonably knows that the organization's interests are adverse to those of the employee. But I think it's a good idea to clarify in the beginning anyways.
The North Carolina rule adopts that same model rule, but there's some commentary in the slide in the North Carolina rule that I think puts some meat on those bones. Why don't you cover that?
Right, and it's also, this is the same commentary in the South Carolina's rules as well. So when we go through the rules, South Carolina adopted the rules and the same commentary as the model rule. But the commentary is basically, there are times when the organization's interests may become adverse to one or more of its constituents, and in such circumstances, the lawyer should advise of the conflict or potential conflict of interest. The lawyer cannot represent such employee, and such person may wish to obtain independent representation.
The fact pattern evolves, and poor Milton gets fired, and the counsel prepares a detailed memo for the CEO following this interview at the regional office. And upon reviewing it, the CEO instructs Wadhams, as I said, or the counsel to fire Wadhams, and to stop the not yet completed internal investigation. And the counsel reluctantly agrees. That raises these questions. What are the potential consequences for the CEO and for the company of shutting down this investigation and of firing Wadhams? And what do you do if you are the general counsel in this situation? Do you have any legal or ethical obligations?
Well, you know, shutting down the investigation, I think we're shutting down the investigation at the point where we know there are suspicious payments. We don't know everything about them, but we think they're possibly illegal. So as from a, in a healthcare arena, there are specific statutes that make it another crime for retaining payment. I don't have the site in front of me, but for retaining payment under circumstances where you believe that you're not entitled to continue keeping that money. I'm not sure about other contexts, but I would be willing to bet that there are other statutes out there that that cover Infotech and other companies like that. So you're basically engaging in a cover-up at that point. The board, the CFO, and other people in the company, although I'm not sure exactly who needs to know, but the board doesn't know. It's just the CEO saying, you know, shut it down. So it raises not only legal problems, but ethical obligations. We're going to go into Model Rule 1.13, which is the same in South Carolina, I think North Carolina. If the lawyer knows that an officer is engaged in an action or intends to act or refuses to act in a matter that's related to the representation, the violation of a legal obligation to the organization, or a violation of law that might reasonably be imputed to the organization. If this was a hospital, it's a separate violation to cover up where you think you're actually no longer entitled to retain the money, or likely to result in substantial injury to the organization. I think that covering up possibly illegal payments is going to result in that. The lawyer shall proceed as is reasonably necessary in the best interest of the organization.
I got ahead of you on the slide there, but then 1.13B continues.
And at this point, the lawyer shall refer the matter to the higher authority in the organization. At this, and I think in this corporation, it sounds like the board is higher than the CEO. He needs to go on and see if he can bring this to attention of someone higher than the CEO to see if he can get this. And we've got the commentary factors that the lawyer should give consideration to. Again, this commentary has also been adopted in South Carolina as well as North Carolina. The lawyer needs to consider the seriousness of the violation and its consequences. You've got several states involved here. The responsibility in the organization and the apparent motivation of the person involved. We don't know exactly what the motivation of the CEO was. I think he just got disgusted and shut it down.
That's a very gentle characterization of what the CEO is up to. I think a prosecutor would come up with a different explanation.
You tell him a defense counsel. He just got tired of dealing with it.
I didn't mean to get ahead of you.
No, that's okay. The policies of the organization concerning such matter and any other relevant considerations. And the ordinarily referral to a higher authority would be necessary. And, I think it would be necessary in this case. You've got a pretty major cover-up. And measures should be taken to minimize the risk of revealing information outside the organization. So certainly, what is his name? Gibbons?
Gibbons is outside.
Outside. So Gibbons, I don't think, should go to the press at this point, but definitely should go to the board and say, I don't think we should shut this down. And even in circumstances where a lawyer is not obligated by the rule to proceed, a lawyer may bring to the client's attention matters that the lawyer reasonably believes important enough to warrant it. So a serious discussion with the CEO about this decision and then consideration of going higher than the CEO is definitely warranted.
What do you do if the board of directors seems completely unimpressed with, as you know, when you're the lawyer, with what you have to say about that? Do you have the ability under the rules to report that to law enforcement?
You know, I don't know. I don't know the answer to that, because I've been fortunate enough, there's 13 years now, not to have had faced that. I have had questioning about the investigation. I have had the, you know, alternative methods of dealing with things, which I think is entirely appropriate, justifying what we found and what were the basis of it and so on and so forth before proceeding, and discussions of how to proceed with what we found. But luckily, I have not been in a position where, you know, the corporation has basically said, well, we thank you very much and have a good day, and oh, well. Has anybody out there? That's a very good question. Has anybody out there faced or has read a discussion about it, or has a hypothetical on how, or ideas on how to handle it at that point?
The easy one is where you learn of illegal conduct that has occurred.
Right.
Confidentiality to your client means you shut up. You don't go tell the cops. If your client refuses, is not going to act, is going to close down the investigation, forget it all ever happened, but it's past. The tough one is where you believe or you know that there's a continuing crime.
Right.
And I think most of the folks I've worked with, if the crime is not a crime of violence, if it's mere money, they don't report it. The one guy I know who did, of course, immediately was terminated, and I think he's probably doing something like traffic tickets somewhere, because he'll never see the inside of a corporation again. But that's the tough call. If all your confidentiality and your duty to your client, you do not reveal outside of the corporation what you've learned. Of course, part of the problem here is you shouldn't have learned all that you've learned so far. Somebody should have shut his water off and let him know that he was hammering himself. But once you know it, I think if it's a past crime, it's over. It's the continuing crime. Or even worse, where you think that this is going to not have been isolated to an employee, you think maybe the CEO who shut down this investigation so immediately may have a whole lot more going on with the recipients of the money. Now you got a tough road to go.
Yeah, my memory of the, now that framework sounds like it comes straight from the rules of civil the rules governing conduct of an attorney. I don't remember the exact rule, but now that you've gone through that, you're absolutely right. I think you go to the rules and see what you can do as a lawyer.
The thing what you have to do is move yourself over, and you're now a criminal defense lawyer.
Right.
Okay, and that's the outfit who knows this stuff pretty well, and
right.
You have a diversion of opinion there.
Right. I think so. And I think you know, as a lawyer, you try to explain some of the consequences for not proceeding, and make sure, you know, even if you can't go outside, to sort of discuss, you know, in the healthcare industry, some of the applicable statutes, the possibility of whistleblowers. There's all sorts of ways that this could and will come out.
Does the rule apply the same to both general counsel or in-house counsel and outside?
I don't think it makes any difference. I think it applies to any citizen. Under the ethical rules, obviously, they only apply to attorneys. But if you're aware of an ongoing criminal offense that is going to continue, I think you've got a tough call.
Well,
I think ethically you're supposed to report it, but I know there's a lot of temporizing. One of the things, and I think the North Carolina comments, you can't stop at the CEO. You're obliged to let the board of directors know. They ultimately are the brain of the corporation.
Right.
So you have to go to them. And then you get into tough darts when all of a sudden it appears to you they're not really going to do anything either. But I do have friends who have reached that point, and suddenly, you know, once they go to a board and you tell them what the CEO didn't want you to tell them, you don't have a whole lot more communication with that corporation, so you can always say, well, I made the report, I honestly don't know if they are or they aren't taking action. Because obviously you're not employed by them anymore.
Right. Do you have a question?
The rule you're looking at is 1.6, which deals with confidentiality. And there are some state versions that require disclosure, but most of the time it's up to the attorney to decide what to do. So even if it's an ongoing crime, there's not a mandate that you must disclose it. What you will run into are other kinds of statutory requirements under Sarbanes-Oxley or governing statutes for particular businesses that may require you to disclose it. The other problem is that if it is an ongoing crime, then the attorney risks putting themselves in the position of being an accomplice.
Right.
So you may not ethically have to report it, but you either at that point need to get out or do something, or you're going to be under investigation by the prosecutor's office along with your client, which is not where you want to be.
I think you have a gentleman sitting alongside of you who may shed some light on the way all of that gets viewed.
Well, I can tell you that Sarbanes-Oxley is right on point, and Mike Ryan was sort of our panel expert on that,
right.
But we can get you through some of the reporting requirements. The hypothetical evolves and tells you to assume that Infotech is a publicly traded company and that Newhouse and Gibbons advised the company on a variety of matters, including SEC filings, and to recall that the two lawyers learn of the suspicious payments while performing their internal investigation for Infotech. That might be Holly.
Holly? You're on speaker. Can you guys hear her? Holly?
Yes, I'm here. Can you all hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. We've got you live. We are just starting Sarbanes-Oxley.
Oh, well, then my timing is good.
Yes, we were on. Actually, we just started Sarbanes-Oxley. We're on discussion point number six.
Holly, let me fill you in. We have just gone through a healthy discussion of what happens when Milton Wadhams gets fired and the CEO directs that the investigation be shut down, and what are the obligations of the lawyers at that point. And the audience has gotten involved and explained that there are any number of rules that would apply, but also Sarbanes-Oxley, which puts us right into some of Mike Ryan's slides. At discussion number six. Have you got yours in front of you there?
I don't.
Oh, dear.
Well, then listen and learn.
Since I put them together, I've been dreaming about them, so I think I can follow you even without them. But, you know, the interesting point, I think, in the slides, and you guys can flip through, is that the Sarbanes rules, like many of them, are less than perfect in giving guidance to lawyers and what they're supposed to be doing. They have mandates that are ambiguous, and certainly, you know, it depends, for example, on how you get involved in the investigation. I think our first scenario is you get involved just this way of the hypothetical fact pattern here. You're called in to do an internal investigation as outside counsel or as the general counsel, and the obligations are somewhat different. If you guys want to flip through the slides and I'll just comment on them as you pull them up, that's fine.
Sure. We're on the slide that has SEC Rule 205 at the top right now.
And so that's the very first one that talks about the obligation to report up essentially to the initially to the chief legal officer if you're the subordinate lawyer and you discover that if you find out that you're in the investigation and something's wrong, you have to report it to the chief legal officer, and then you don't have any other obligations as outside counsel unless you feel like the chief legal officer or CEO or whoever you did, in fact, report to does not take appropriate action. So you have a little more leeway if you're brought in to do an internal investigation to defer to the appropriateness of the legal officer reporting.
Holly, your ability to spit that out off the cuff is amazing. Let me make sure everybody in the back can hear that under our kind of medium tech system here. Everybody's nodding their heads. Okay, good. So we're doing great. Holly, we're going to slip over to the next slide, which discusses Sarbanes-Oxley requirements again and evolves the hypothetical to assume that instead of discovering the suspicious payments in an internal investigation, they learn of these while working on a corporate deal for Infotech.
Right, and then that's where the obligations get a little bit more ambiguous, because that is where you get into the definition of what a lawyer practicing before the SEC is, and of course that definition is defined to really swallow anything that even touches the SEC. So even if you're not a securities lawyer, if you're just, you know, one of us criminal defense lawyers who's unburdened by any detailed knowledge of anything securities, if you are working on anything that you even think might be filed or go to the SEC, you are deemed to be a lawyer practicing in front of the SEC, and therefore your obligations under Sarbanes are triggered, which seems to be a little bit wide sweeping. And then
we're going through the slides now, Holly, that show what it means to be appearing and practicing before the SEC.
Right, and you may want to just run through those.
The slide that's up now provides that you're engaged in appearing and practicing before the SEC if you provide advice on securities laws or SEC rules regarding any document that the attorney has noticed will be filed or submitted to the SEC or incorporated in any such document, including preparing or participating in the preparation of it. It also is applicable when you're advising an issuer as to whether information, statements, or opinions need to be filed or submitted to the SEC or, again, incorporated in such a document. The ongoing slides provide more definition, Holly. And it says the rule requires a covered attorney to report to the chief legal officer or to the chief legal officer and the CEO under certain circumstances.
Right, and that's basically the same circumstances that we were talking about. If you feel like something needs to be done, or if you uncover something that needs some sort of action by the company, either, you know, remedial or prophylactic going forward, you have an obligation to report. And the real kicker there is you have an obligation to report to them. And then they have to take what you deem to be quote unquote appropriate action, and then they have to report back to you. So imagine you're the junior lawyer in house, and you have to go tell your general counsel boss of something you've uncovered in the course of doing some corporate deal. Then that general counsel has the obligation to go take, quote, appropriate action and report back to you as though you're the boss. And then if you don't like the action they've taken, which you also have an obligation under the rule to decide, you must elevate it above his head. So, you know, it may be a great thing for the SEC, but it obviously sets up a dynamic that is extremely politically touchy for outside and inside counsel to try to deal with if you're not the senior lawyer on the scene.
We're going to go, Holly, you're right on point with the slides, and we're going to go to the last one before the break in today's presentation, which provides that if the reporting attorney doesn't believe that the chief legal officer or CEO has provided a good enough response within a reasonable time, then what the reporting attorney's obligations are.
Right, and they have to, you know, the reporting attorney has to report basically over the general counsel's head, and take it up to either the audit committee or to the appropriate body above the board of directors, some committee of the board of directors, or to the full board of directors if there isn't some appropriate committee to go to. And obviously going over your boss's head because of something you loosely defined as, quote, inappropriate, you know, it doesn't say illegal, unethical, it just says appropriate, is a little bit difficult for a lot of lawyers to swallow, and it's put a lot of people in, I think, an awkward situation vis-a-vis their bosses and their companies.
Unless
before you take the break, why don't you structure the factual restructure for us, the factual issue that's now giving us trouble, because Holly wasn't here when, and she knows it, I'm sure, but she wasn't here when we actually got to that slide where they reported to the CEO and he said, thank you very much, fire the guy. And that was the end of the matter.
Right, I think under our hypothetical, you would have an obligation if Infotech is a publicly traded company, which we're assuming. I think that both Gibbons and Newhouse would have an obligation to go over the CEO's head to the board. Because he's certainly doing, under the ethics rules that I think they just outlined for you, he's certainly doing something inappropriate.
In terminating the investigation?
Yes. I don't think in firing the employee, but I think in terminating the investigation that's showing something negative without finishing it, taking any action for it, and then you later find out, you know, one of the reasons is because he's complicit. So I think you would be on unsteady ground, at least in my opinion, if you didn't elevate that. And, you know, the ethics rules say that even if you're not obligated to take action, that you're allowed to, even if you don't think some illegality is going on, and I think that would be the safer course. What do you guys think?
I agree. Audience, any disagreement or other? I think at that point, Holly, I was also talking about the fact that there are other statutes that actually could, you could be not only the original crimes, but you might be stepping into violating other laws, such as the laws in the healthcare arena where that you trip over once you realize that you no longer have the right to retain a payment and you continue to retain it, you might have a problem. So you might be tripping over other laws as well.
Right, and I mean, even as a technicality, you could have tax consequences as to how those, you know, payments were recorded and produced, false statements on your financials, you know. I mean, it may not be that they're material. I don't know that we said how many they were, but you're absolutely right that there's a lot more legal risk in there.
Let me ask a question. One of the recitals was to the effect that the executive director, the chief executive, it tells Newhouse, the lawyer, to fire the employee. That, at least that's the way it's worded.
Okay.
I think if I were the general counsel and somebody, even my boss, told me to fire somebody, I would say, you do it. Because otherwise you move from failure to act to evading and abetting. But I just wondered whether I was reading it too literally. Or am I correct in that distinction?
Well, it's a good distinction. I think it was one of those things we just didn't really think about when we put that slide together. But it's a good point that you know, Newhouse probably should push back and say, yeah, thanks, but no thanks. If you want that done, do it yourself.
A lot of this corporation this size has the human resources department. I think you'd be working with them to figure out how to handle that. At least that's the way I've handled it when it's had to be done.
Yep.
Well, that puts us at our, there's one question in the back.
The question I have is for the average small town lawyer practicing behind his desk, somebody walks in as a new client and says, I want you to form a corporation for me. Or alternatively says, I'm the chief executive of the ABC Corporation, and we want you to represent us. And I think the answer at that point is, gee, I wish I could help you.
Josh, I'm not sure I got all that.
I wonder if we could repeat that one more time for Holly.
What I'm suggesting is that somebody walks in and says, I want you to form a corporation for me. Or alternatively, I'm the chief executive officer of whatever, and our corporation wants you to be retained as our attorney. And I wonder if the next response on your part is, sorry, I can't help you.
Do you mean because you think that there's too many now legal areas at risk where you can't be a generalist and do it, or do you mean because you think your personal exposure as an attorney is too high?
It seems to me... seems to me it might make you uneasy, let me put it that way.
You know, I think you have a good point. I guess my gut instinct on that, and guys, feel free to jump in, is that I don't think you have to say no, but I think you have to make sure that, sort of like being a doctor, you have to stay up to date on the procedures you're going to be performing. And so if you're going to be in the corporate world, even in a, you know, small town setting like you posit, I think you're going to have to stay up to date on corporations and all the laws affecting them, and I think you would have to, you know your Sarbanes-Oxley responsibilities and be ready and willing to pull that trigger with your corporate client if you got to that point. And I do think, you know, if you decided it's too much to try to keep up with all of that, but I'll tell you, I think the big firm lawyers are in big towns are struggling with the same things. I think the issues are the same whether you're a small town lawyer or a big firm lawyer in a big town, because everybody's put in an awkward position by these rules.
Rules are not so complicated that once you get into fooling with corporations or corporate representation, you don't know where you are.
Well, in the second half of the presentation,
what may happen to you?
We'll get even more complicated, which is put into an overlay of this criminal exposure and how to avoid getting the company indicted, even if you commit civil malpractice. We'll take a judge. How long will the break be?
They just need to change the tape. She said about 5 minutes, 5-10 minutes.
All right. Holly, stay on the line.
Yeah, I'm just going to stay.
Yeah, don't be leaving us. I don't know if I can get you back.
Well, I know. I just got your email with the number for some reason, so.
Resume the program. I was asked during the break if our panel had some materials. Did you find some? Is everybody, if anybody would like these materials, or I guess they're available at Doris Kelly's desk up front. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, and it's our materials in the Thompson and McNulty memoranda. So,
Holly, do you agree that you release any trademarks on your remarks? This is Walter.
I do.
Okay.
Holly, I encourage everyone to waive as many rights as possible.
I know. You
okay,
black-booted Nazi.
All right, the defense counsel's got to object here.
The next stage, or the next half of the presentation, gets much more into the criminal overlay of this kind of conduct. And let me start off and sort of make a disclaimer, which is that to the extent that I issue opinions and recommendations, it's not at all as a DOJ official, but rather as a guy who halfway knows what he's talking about. And Holly, also having substantial department experience, can chime in at any point, and she and I worked together for years, so she knows where I'm coming from on that. But most importantly, let me give you some context that might otherwise be missing from the slides, which is that we're going to focus in the second half on two major issues in Infotech's fact pattern, which is that what can they do to continue to pay attorneys' fees, and another part is perhaps most interesting to y'all, what happens to the privilege issues when DOJ shows up and would be interested in potentially privileged information? Attorney-client privilege waivers and the second aspect, which is paying for attorney's fees, are just two elements of nine elements that go into the decision-making as to whether or not to charge a corporation criminally. And so I don't want the discussion of just those two of nine elements, which will be lengthy today, to overshadow the fact that there are seven other elements. And while they're not going to come up on the slides, let me tell you the kinds of things that are taken into account. You'll see discussions of the Thompson Memorandum and the McNulty Memo. The reason this is new is because the McNulty Memo just came out a few months ago. The Thompson Memorandum has really been with us since the days of Enron, and it set out those nine factors, and McNulty just modified their application. The nine factors are these, and I'll abbreviate them. The nature and seriousness of the offense is the first factor, and that includes the risk of harm to the public and any policies or priorities governing the prosecution of corporations for a particular category of crime. The second factor is the pervasiveness of wrongdoing within the corporation, including the complicity of corporate management. The third is the corporation's history of similar conduct. That's a very, very important factor. You know, at any seminar like this, you'll get questions from the crowd when you're in my seat about the wisdom of charging Arthur Anderson. One of the key factors in their case was that they had a history of similar conduct. And we won't talk much about that in this slide presentation, but again, don't let the discussion of this fourth factor and also whether or not they're still paying attorney's fees cause you to think that those are the only two issues for a prosecutor. A history of similar conduct is very important. Now, one thing we will cover in length today is the corporation's timely and voluntary disclosure of wrongdoing and its willingness to cooperate in the investigation. Now, what has changed in the McNulty memo, or through the McNulty memo, about that factor has to do with this, which is the waiver of attorney-client and work product protections. We'll get into that point and the new changes in great detail. A fifth factor, which is very important to any charging decision, is the existence and adequacy of a corporation's compliance program. If you have a compliance program, that's great, but if it's entirely a paper tiger, then you know we won't be very impressed when it comes time to make a decision. It needs to actually have life and have substance. And for those of you who do compliance work, that should thrill you, because we will look into that, and you should pitch that when it comes time to decision-making by DOJ. The sixth factor is something we'll talk about as a little bit today, which is the corporation's remedial actions, including any efforts after the fact to implement a corporate compliance program or to improve the existing one, to replace responsible management, to discipline or terminate wrongdoers, to pay restitution, and to cooperate with relevant government agencies. One of the things that I think we can put under that banner is, do you continue to pay attorney's fees for people that are wrongdoers in this, under this fact pattern? The seventh factor are collateral consequences, including disproportionate harm to shareholders. Another issue with Arthur Anderson is that, you know, 28,000 people lost their jobs as a result of that entity's collapse. What's interesting about an accounting firm, or particularly a partnership, is that there aren't necessarily then a whole lot of entirely uninvolved individual investors, because it's not a publicly traded entity necessarily. And whereas if you were talking about General Motors or any other Fortune 500 company that does trade stock, and people are trying to send their kids to college on that or trying to retire on those funds, then that collateral consequence of a criminal prosecution is very weighty. The last two of the nine factors are the adequacy of the prosecution of individuals responsible for the corporation's malfeasance and the adequacy of civil or regulatory enforcement remedies, which could be letting, you know, plaintiff's lawyer nibble you to death, or let the SEC and federal plaintiffs or governmental plaintiffs handle it as a civil matter. So those are the nine factors, and it's a long list. And so don't get the impression that if you don't waive the privilege, you're going to get indicted. That's just one factor. And as you'll see in the discussion of what the McNulty memo did to change the Thompson factors, it ain't much of one. And so be sure, if you're trying to make a pitch to save a corporation from indictment, or map out a way to save the corporation that you advise from indictment, keep all nine of those in mind. We'll just focus on two key factors today, because those are the ones that have most recently changed. Now, Alice, I think the fact pattern that we have in this case has evolved.
Right. And also, I just wanted to mention, if we did it correctly, you've got the McNulty memorandum and the Thompson memorandum in your materials. So those nine factors are discussed thoroughly in McNulty, which is the current guidance. So you can pull that up and read it over. All right, so we back to our scenario. The fired employee has gone to the media to talk about the illegal payments, and within a day, the DOJ announces this intention to conduct a criminal investigation of Infotech. The AUSA then talks to in-house counsel regarding the company's cooperation in the investigation. And she makes it clear that Infotech's full cooperation in the investigation will be appreciated and can be looked upon quite favorably by the government. And she asked Newhouse for Infotech to agree to disclose all information related to any internal investigation, including any documents that may be subject and materials that may be subject to protection under the attorney-client and or the work product doctrine. And so the question for Josh and Holly is, was the AUSA comments and waiver request appropriate first under the Thompson memo?
The Thompson memo was the initial guidance we in the field got after all the corporate scandals of Enron and WorldCom and Global Crossing. But it's not the first time we've had guidance of this nature, and it's not even solely a beast of the Bush administration. The Holder memorandum by then Deputy Attorney General Eric Holder, which came out during the Clinton years, had very similar guidance for corporate prosecutors. The Thompson memorandum is as often necessary to bureaucracy, just rearticulated and clarified some of those points. And it made it very clear, when there, you know, was great weeping and gnashing of teeth over the colossal bankruptcy of Enron, that in prosecuting corporate crime, AUSAs such as myself should not hesitate to ask for a corporation who has done an internal investigation, like many of you may do, to go ahead and waive any privilege issues and get us as prosecutors, you know, to the bottom line. Who did what wrong? Because frankly, we didn't have the resources at the time and still don't to duplicate that effort. Now, as a result, under the Thompson memo and the question we have posed here, AUSA Martin's comments and waiver requests were perfectly okay, and she need not go beyond her own office to get that permission. She could have at the time done that herself.
Well, and Josh, I want to jump in there for 1 second, because the only real difference, honestly, between the Holder memo under the Clinton administration and Thompson was that they called the Thompson memorandum binding. And as you and I both know, as you, a current AUSA, and me, an ex-1, trying to give binding guidance from D.C. on, you know, line prosecutors in the field is somewhat of an anomaly, and it's much like herding cats. So for, I think, practical purposes, that wasn't much of a distinction, although that's the distinction that always gets touted. And I also think you're right that it was clearly much more appropriate under Thompson for her to ask for this waiver. But, you know, even Thompson, now it was in a footnote that people may not have focused on, even Thompson cautioned that you should only do that, you know, if you can show a need, or I can't remember, I think the language is in one of the slides that we have up there about the footnote. I think it's 3 or 4.
Yeah,
it's some caveat on you ought to only do it if there's a need or something like that. But it's a very general, and I think in most cases you were going to be able to show that there was a need.
Isn't she good? She does this. She doesn't even have slides where she is in Chicago. She just does this off her head, and she's correct. Holly, the footnote 3 is on the screen, and it provides that this waiver should ordinarily be limited to the factual internal investigation and any contemporaneous advice given to the corporation concerning the conduct at issue. And except in unusual circumstances, prosecutors should not seek a waiver with respect to those communications and work product related to advice concerning the government's criminal investigation.
And we don't have to spend a lot of time talking about that, because that's the distinction that McNulty picks up on, and we'll talk about a little bit further down the road. But, you know, even in Thompson, despite all the clamoring of, you know, everybody's being walking the door and the first thing they do is ask for a privilege waiver, I think that there was some effort in Thompson to limit it. And I also want to say, generally, even though I'm on the defense side now, I believe that I don't remember ever asking anybody for a waiver when I was a prosecutor. A lot of times people would come in and do attorney proffers, and we'll talk about that too, but I don't remember ever asking for it. I'm not sure I would have thought it was inappropriate to ask, but I don't remember ever asking for one or ever having the need for one in the cases that I did, and I did mostly white-collar cases. That said, I don't think it would have been inappropriate to ask for them, but I just think that sometimes, you know, the clamor and the stir about something is much greater than the actual practice.
The literature on this point, and there's a great degree of scholarly writing from folks outside the department, not as much in defense of it from within the department. The scholarly writing says that there's a culture of waiver created by the Thompson Memorandum. And I think the point you should take out of Thompson is that, first of all, to the extent there's a culture of waiver, it is typically because the corporate clients regard the waiver as being in their best interests. And then secondly, this is not something that the Bush Justice Department was the first to do. It's something that has gone from Clinton and then into Bush and has been critiqued by officials, which is part of the phenomenal amount of scholarly literature, critiqued by officials from both administrations. There's a letter in a package that Alice and Holly and I have talked about, signed by just about every one of the last few attorney generals, solicitors general, Ken Starr, Walter Dellinger, people from both sides that critique the culture of waiver. Fortunately, the McNulty memo has changed a lot of this. And Alice, you've got slides that will raise this question. Under the McNulty memo, AUSA Martins wouldn't be nearly so bold. Let's skip right on to, you know, where we can request a waiver. The ultimate answer here is that if we're going to do that now, we've got to go to Washington, which is an enormous wet blanket on anything an AUSA has to do.
That's very true.
One of the amazing things, tax cases are traditionally a real pain for a local AUSA, because about anything you would have done as a matter of course in any other kind of case has to go through Washington, and two or three people have to write memos about it, and it takes them months to even approve a plea agreement where the guy wants to plead guilty. And
Same thing with RICO charges. You have to get DOJ approval. I'm sure there are other examples, but for that reason, you tend to shy away from them if you have other options.
So this is one of many things in the department where you substantially reduce the number of applications you're going to get just by creating a Washington bureaucracy to handle this. But it's well designed, and it has certain standards that the applying AUSA, or really U.S. Attorney's Office, has to prove to Maine Justice so they can track and even-handedly afford offices an opportunity to seek these waivers. They have to show there's a legitimate need. And, Holly, we're on the slide that outlines what determines a legitimate need.
Right.
These factors are the likelihood and degree to which the privileged information will benefit the government's investigation, the timeliness and availability of alternative means to get that same information, the completeness of the voluntary disclosure already provided, and the collateral consequences of waiver. McNulty,
Point out here, Josh, I think, too, that it has to be in writing, and you can't just, maybe an email would suffice, but you can't just pick up the phone. I mean, sometimes if you have to get DOJ approval, like from PREA or something, you can do that pretty easily in an expedited fashion, but here, you know, your request as an AUSA for a waiver approval has to be in writing, and then it goes to you know, through the levels we'll get ready to talk about, and then you have to get something back in writing. So that adds a layer of bureaucratic sort of nonsense to the whole process that really is a deterrent for the government.
The last factor here, and I think we'll come back to this in slides, but y'all in the audience don't let us forget this. The collateral consequences of waiver are very significant, and the question will become, can you make a partial waiver that spares the company that's trying to comply with the government's investigation the pain of having that information out in the public for later civil litigation? And the dean designate spoke earlier, Holly, when he introduced the panel today and explained very artfully that there's a proposed rule of evidence, 502C, and it would provide for the codification of a partial waiver.
Right.
And what's beautiful about that then is that you can find situations as an AUSA where the company is fervently arguing that if they make a waiver, then they're ruined on the civil side, and so they don't want to make a waiver. Well, the disingenuity of that is something you have to gauge. And if we had that rule, then we could avoid that. You know, we could both avoid that that dilemma.
Right. It's a bit of a double-edged sword, as you and I were discussing earlier this week. It's a bit of a double-edged sword for the corporate world because they've been arguing that they want the, you know, if there were only a limited waiver, we could help you so much more. But, you know, it's one of those, be careful what you ask for, because it's one of the bows in our quiver that we won't be able to have anymore to be able to say, gee, you know, Josh, I'd love to help you out, but if I waive as to this, I waive as to all, and I just can't run that risk. I'm sure you understand. You know, and that argument is now taken away from the lawyer representing the corporation, which is a bit of a catch 22.
Well, I think coming from the civil side and seeing how all this evolved, I think from my perspective, a lot of lawyers who are going in and doing investigations now feel the possibility at all points when they're doing the investigation that this might come to fruition. And so you may find that the corporations in the future, if they had that extra protection, okay, you can tell them from the defense side here, you might have, might be more willing to do a partial waiver if the collateral consequences outside of the dealing with the government weren't possibly so dramatic.
Right.
Because I know that, I go into it, and discuss it with my client that's the potential down the line as we get started. The beauty of having the protection of the privileges as you're starting is at least you have a chance to investigate and start to understand what's going on before you get to the point where you may be disclosing or hopefully.
Right.
I think realistically, a lot of people, including myself, and you guys may comment on that, I have a much more of an awareness these days that, my file may be opened up, and we try to have a very open-handed dealings with the government when it comes to that point anyways, as a showing of cooperation.
The McNulty memo divides the field of information, the universe of information that may be privileged, into two categories. The first is Category 1 information, which we'll put some meat on those bones in a minute, but it's defined now as purely factual information that may or may not be privileged. Category 2 things are more squarely attorney-client communications or non-factual attorney work product, including legal advice given to the corporation before, during, and after the underlying misconduct.
And that's back to that same distinction that Thompson made very generally in the footnote 3 that just didn't get picked up and focused on as much. I mean, that's essentially what he said. You should only really ask for Category 1 information, and only in rare circumstances should you ask for Category 2. But now there's a process that you have to go through where with Category 1, you have to get the U.S. attorney has to talk to an AAG up in D.C. for you to get it. And for Category 2, you know, you have to get it straight from the DAG, from the DAG, from the Deputy Attorney General, the number 2 guy at Justice. So, and Category 1, if they ask for that waiver, get the approval and ask the company for it, it can be used against the company if they don't give it. But Category 2 cannot be used against the company. Even if they get all the approvals and ask for it, it technically is not supposed to be factored in. Now, you know, query whether that's like telling the jury 3 times to disregard what was just said by a witness. Does it ring, you know, can you unring that bell? Is it something people can really put out of their minds? I think most prosecutors could, but I think that's a difficult kind of analysis to make. And I think there's always going to be the criticism of that distinction is that there's going to be a worry by the corporate American citizens that the DOJ lawyers may say they're not going to take it, hold it against them, but you never can really be able to tell. I mean, how do you know for certain? So I think that may put some subtle pressure on the corporate client to waive, even if it's not technically supposed to be used against them. And I also think that the one problem with separating Category 1 and Category 2 information, as the McNulty and Thompson memo essentially have, is the stuff we'll get into in a minute about the limited waiver and that sort of thing, because Category 1, you could still be waiving some work product or attorney-client privileged information that's factual, and then you have a waiver problem even though it's the less onerous or less sacrosanct protected kind of information. And if you've waived as to that, you know, have you waived that to everything, and does it really at that point make a difference that you have two categories because you've executed a broad waiver by giving the Category 1 information? So those are my thoughts on the category distinctions. I think they're an improvement, but there's still some risk areas for the corporate citizens out there.
We'll get in a moment to a discussion that asks, you know, are there ways to share the relevant and potentially privileged information without waiving that privilege? But before we leave the Category 1 area and the Category 2 area, I really want to impress upon the practicing bar the significance of the idea that a U.S. attorney would have to go to Washington and talk to somebody at the Assistant Attorney General level to even seek a Category 1 waiver. As you all have learned in recent weeks, most of the time when a U.S. attorney gets a call like that from Washington and it's asked for their resignation, it's it's a very rare thing. And Holly, we're getting late laughter.
I hear that.
The Category 1 waiver is something, frankly, the McNulty memo is so new that in the two districts I've been in, I have not been a part of a request for such a waiver, so I can't tell you yet, you know, the frequency of success or failure in applying for those. I can tell you that a Category 2 waiver bears all of the hallmarks that I have seen, especially even spending a year at the Office of Legal Policy in generating processes like this. The Category 2 waiver bears all the hallmarks that it is no small feat, and it had better be a major investigation. The Category 2 waiver is going to protect what most of you consider your privileged information and your work product. But Category 1, and I said I'd put some meat on these bones, examples of that information are provided in the McNulty memo, and you'll see it on page 9 of the handout. Examples of Category 1 information could include copies of key documents, witness statements, or purely factual interview memoranda regarding the underlying misconduct, even organization charts created by company counsel. You would be surprised at how important that is, especially in a large company, because if we don't have any help from the company, we really have to reconstruct the organization chart from witness statements. And even in my own entity, in the Justice Department, if you asked the lawyers and the DEA and the ATF where they fall on the umbrella, they would explain it to you in a certain way. And the FBI is under that umbrella, but I don't think they'd ever tell you they're under it. I think they would tell you that they are their own organization. And you could definitely get that same dynamic in a private company where the chain of command is not nearly as well established, and it could take months to figure out just who answers to who and who has joint authority or supervision. And if a law firm has done an internal investigation or the general counsel's office has done it, something like that is incredibly helpful, and it's squarely within Category 1 information that I would be surprised if that, you know, really upset the apple cart too much with regard to collateral consequences, you know, for subsequent litigation. Factual chronologies, factual summaries, or reports containing the investigative facts documented by counsel would all be under Category 1. Category 2 gets into much more traditional attorney-client privileged and work product materials. We're kind of flipping quickly through the slides, Holly, the waiver under the McNulty Memorandum of Category 2 information should only be sought by an AUSA such as Ms. Martin's in this hypothetical in rare circumstances, and you've got to get permission squarely from the Deputy Attorney General. And again, that is no small feat. Most importantly, if you go as an AUSA and get these permissions, and a company refuses to turn over Category 1 information, I think, Holly, you've already said this.
Right.
That can be factored in to a charging decision. But if you refuse to turn over Category 2 stuff, which is much more typically and traditionally within the realm of privileged materials, then that cannot now, under the McNulty Memorandum, be factored into a charging decision.
Well, I'm sure you talked about this earlier, Josh, but one of the things we discussed when we were all discussing these slides is a lot of this comes down to trust between the AUSA and the lawyer representing the company. If you believe me when I tell you that I can't give you information because I give it to you 9 out of 10 times, I think that matters. I think if I believe you when you say I only want this information to help me and I'm not going to, you know, deliberately try to use it against your client, you know, if you have trust with the lawyer and the AUSA, or you can build that trust, I think that a lot of these the problems with these issues go away. And I think that, you know, in the jurisdictions in North Carolina in which most of these people practice, and I'm sure it's true actually in South Carolina too, you know, I do think there is a lot of rapport between the U.S. attorney's offices and the defense bar. I don't think that's true everywhere. And I think that's where the press articles and the breakdown of this process sometimes gets a lot more traction. Because I do think a lot of these issues come down to trust that you're going to play fair on both sides.
The big trick here for practicing attorneys is that you can spare all of us this heartache by voluntarily offering it, kind of proactively saying, listen, we've got these materials, and here they are. And that spares the AUSA the requesting process, and it also does something that may very much be in the shareholders' interest. And it's not just to earn credit under one of the 9 sentencing or charging factors, but rather, if you speak with any board of directors or any CEO, and it's now publicly known that their entity is under investigation, this thing could drag on for months or years. And that's going to be a very negative influence on your stock value or your other capitalization. If you have something that could speed up that investigation and get a resolution one way or the other right away, why not get rid of that, you know, that long extended suppression of the stock value? Why not help
the
government come to that?
I think the practicing tip, and I'd be interested in what the audience thinks about this since we've been talking for a while, but practicing tip from my perspective, and I was, you know, practicing healthcare investigating attorney, you know, before I was a prosecutor, and so now I'm back, you know, I flip back and forth just to keep things interesting, but it seems to me that the truth of the matter factually really is, Josh, that on our side of the fence, as defense lawyers, you really only want to come in and give information if you've got a rogue, if you've got one or two people that are rogue wrongdoers that you can, you know, for lack of a better term, throw under the bus. If you've got widespread fraudulent conduct at the top of your organization chart, you don't care how long that investigation goes on, that information is bad.
Y'all remember at the beginning when I talked about Holly's force of personality. that's what I meant.
Well, what does everybody else think about that? I mean, I think the truth is we only want to come in and talk to you if we have something good to tell you, and otherwise we don't.
I mean, without doing that, you very often run the risk of having all sorts of agents with all sorts of badges showing up at people's houses at nights, you know, trying to get information because you won't cooperate. If at the very least, if you
not can, if you lawyer them up, you don't.
Well, exactly. At the very least, you can, you know, make logistical arrangements and potentially spare a lot of these interviews because you've already invented the wheel. You know, why have the government do it again in the public eye? Now,
well, I mean, obviously, you know, the criticism on our side of the fence of that policy is, and again, I do think it comes down to trust and relationships, but I think the criticism on of that policy is, you know, I know you, and I know you would do it exactly the way it's supposed to be. We also both know some prosecutors who are a little heavier-handed than maybe you and I are, or were, and then that makes the situation different. But the bottom line is, I think that, you know, the corporate American defense lawyers feel like they're being made into, you know, quasi-FBI agents to do your work for you. And I understand the resource problem, but, you know, that's something that really rubs against the grain for defense lawyers to feel like we now have to start out our investigations with the idea that we're basically going to hand you over an indictable case and outline it for you.
Ignoring for the moment the retort of good corporate citizenship, let's go to how to the next slide, discussion eight, which is how attorneys might share the relevant information without waiving the privilege. As it stands, 502C is not law. And as it stands, in some of the materials, Holly, that you shared with Alice and I, there's a great George Terwilliger article who inventories, he's a former deputy attorney general, inventories case law all over the country, and even in one federal district in and of itself that is contradictory on the ability of parties or corporations in the Department of Justice to protect through writing or otherwise disclosures you make from subsequent disclosure to outside interests when the civil litigation starts.
Right.
The fact pattern, Holly, evolves, and Alice, I'll leave this to you.
Okay. After conferring with the CEO and outside counsel Gibbons, Newhouse advises the AUSA that the company wants to cooperate. Newhouse, however, was reluctant to waive attorney-client privilege and work product protection as to the government, so they execute a confidentiality agreement. And after the agreement was executed, Newhouse provided the AUSA with the attorney notes about Wadlam's interview, as well as Newhouse's written memo to CEO Scott regarding the same. Newhouse did not inform the AUSA about the questionnaires, nor did he produce the remaining notes and reports related to the internal investigation. So the first question, which I think is an interesting one, is that confidentiality agreement enforceable?
I think this is another real danger area for lawyers, because I think that there is only one circuit that currently recognizes the validity of the confidentiality or will enforce the confidentiality agreement. I think it's the Eighth Circuit, if I recall correctly. But then there are state courts that even in the same jurisdiction go opposite ways. But I also think, even though they're not really enforceable, you don't want to be the lawyer that doesn't have one in the jurisdiction that decides to enforce them. So I think that it may be a total exercise in futility, but the best practice is to always get them, knowing that they're probably not going to protect you.
Okay, which brings up another question. Should Newhouse have disclosed the existence of other internal investigation documents, and what are the potential consequences of a failure to disclose?
Well, and this is less of a legal question, and I think, Josh, you'd probably be better off to give your opinion on this, that what this is trying to get at is, you know, technically, AUSA Martins in our earlier hypo asked for everything and defined cooperation in her request for it as all information about the internal investigation. And by just giving over this little bit of information, have you now breached the trust that you have with this AUSA by either implying that that's all that you have when it clearly isn't, or are you okay to make some sort of partial rolling disclosure? Josh, what do you think?
Well, and there's a difference between partial rolling disclosure and then a partial disclosure that it's not clear that it is rolling, that it's somehow deceptive or leaves confusion as to the real facts of the matter.
Right.
And, you know, that's one. And Holly, when we prepared this, quoted one of our former colleagues that Judge Horn knows well, Kenny Smith, who, what does Kenny say about that, Holly?
He always says, well, you can deceive me if you want to, but just remember, I'm going to see you down the road.
And that's, Kenny has a great way with colloquialisms that, you know, makes the real point for the purposes of North Carolina practitioners. This is not such a large bar that you could get away with that for the course of a career. You know, maybe in the Southern District of New York, somebody could do that and consider it a success, but it may be a success in one case down here, but it's not, you're not going to get away with it the second time.
And I think there's an easy way to avoid that, especially if it's not what you intended, if you didn't intend to imply that that was all you had, just that was all you were prepared to give. You just need to have that open communication with the AUSA and say, listen, I'm going to start with this, see if this gets you what you need, and if it doesn't, you know, we'll go back to the table and figure it out, so that it's clear that you're not trying to imply that that's all you have.
And I would encourage all the practitioners here to realize, too, that it may well be that the AUSA you're dealing with has no civil experience, certainly not beyond maybe a federal clerkship. And so they may not fully appreciate or recognize all the consequences of a waiver, and they're not going to be real good at generating ways to avoid unfortunate disclosures. But I would hope that you find that they're open to working with you on that. Certainly anybody in my shop now will take half a loaf when they can get it, because you're crazy not to take what you can get for free, as long as, you know, the defense bar or the corporate counsel is explaining that this is not full disclosure, this is just the best we can do now. There was a question in the back.
Yeah, I think one of the things that we're dodging around with, and I think it's being cured somewhat because they're professionalizing white-collar prosecutors, where they do get educated about what corporate counsel are facing in the civil arena, the problems the corporate counsel has with identity of client. But even with that, and no, I do not believe and have never suggested to any lawyer that they go lie to an AUSA, because, you know, sooner or later that guy can put you in jail, get your law license. But at the same time, there are an awful lot of AUSAs out there who will not or cannot, because of DOJ rules or the rules of their office, they can't give you anything in return. And, yeah, it often seems like, oh, you want to make me an arm of the government to investigate my client, but you're not in a position to grant immunity, to agree that you're not going to pursue certain individuals. I mean, it's not like a negotiation with, you know, another civil counsel when you're into some fight between corporations. And so I think once you start down the road of giving up more than you're absolutely required to give up, you can get on a real slippery slope real fast with prosecutors who can mislead you. And then, gee, Tom, I really thought we could do that, but my hands are tied. The U.S. attorney tells me, we're going to take the CEO's wife, we're going to rip the kids from her bosom, we're going to destroy everything we can find. And you stand there doing what? Enforcing a contract against an AUSA? I don't think so.
Well, I think you make a good point. I mean, obviously there are better prosecutors and there are worse ones. And, you know, I'm a big person about quotes and sayings, as you can probably tell from the limited exposure you've had to me today. But Ronald Reagan had a great quote that was trust but verify. And I think that if you don't trust the AUSA you're dealing with, or you don't know if you can trust them, one way to get them to put their money where their mouth is to get it in writing. Because even if it's not an enforceable contract, as you say, the Department of Justice does at least mostly hold itself to a pretty high standard of fair play. And I think an AUSA would be very hard-pressed to, you know, put something in writing to you about these issues and then renege on it. At a minimum, I mean, Judge Horn, you might want to comment if you're still there. I don't think you would tolerate that in your court. It would be frowned upon quite significantly.
That's correct, Holly. How are you doing?
Good to talk to you. Yeah, sorry, I'm not there to see you.
You're doing a great job.
So I think that, you know, if to the extent that they can, I do think, Josh, I mean, you may want to comment on this too, that, you know, sometimes prosecutors' arms are tied, whereas yours aren't. And, it is sort of like negotiating. To me, it's like buying a house. You might as well not read the documents because they're not negotiable. So the government does have a lot of authority and power, and it certainly is not a level playing field. My experience, though, as a prosecutor, I always told them a lot of what I knew on the defense side because it doesn't help me, and frankly, it would be embarrassing to me if I think the facts are a certain way, they know they're not that way, and I go indict their client and have egg all over my face. So I tried to give, and I also know that clients, you know, shockingly, don't always tell you everything bad they've ever done the first time they walk in the door. It's a process. They don't just walk in and say, yeah, I stole, you know, $500 million from this corporation. It's in my Cayman's account. So I think that the government has to realize as well, to your point, that they've got to give you enough information to unlock the tongue of your client. Because if you don't have any leverage over your client or have information, you can't get them to do the right thing. So I agree with you that it needs to be more of a symbiotic process, but I just don't know how to address that other than trying to do those few things.
We are running short on time, so let's keep moving through the slides.
Okay.
There are unintended consequences in the subject matter waiver. In the slide, Holly provides that recall that AUSA Martins has obtained attorney notes about the Milton Wadhams interview, as well as Newhouse's written memo regarding that interview. The AUSA has caused a grand jury subpoena to be issued demanding the production of those questionnaires and the notes and memos resulting from the internal investigation. Newhouse and Gibbons refused to produce, asserting the attorney-client privilege and the work product doctrine. The questions that raises, which you have well framed, are at least four in number. In light of the subpoena, should Newhouse have provided the attorney notes and memo to the government?
And I think we can kind of talk about all these questions that are on this slide in one sort of fell swoop in the interest of time. And I think the bottom line with subject matter waiver is the law is that if you waive the privilege, then you waive it as to everything privileged on that subject matter. Now, what does that mean? Your guess is as good as mine. I think, frankly, it means whatever the judge says the scope of the subject matter waiver is. And so it's a dangerous slope to be on. And I think, you know, how do you avoid that? Again, I think you get it in writing. I think you get the government to agree up front that if you provide this to them, it doesn't, you know, this is different than your confidentiality agreement where you're trying to protect against waiver to everybody else. But I think you need to get the government to agree at least for the purpose of the investigation that they will not seek a subject matter waiver before you turn over anything attorney-client privileged. Or I think that they can go after anything on the same subject matter, you know, defined as broadly or narrowly as the court that you're in front of defines it.
That's a good point. Let's keep sliding to some of the investigative techniques. When the corporation pulls in private investigators, Holly, many of you in the audience will recognize some familiarity with the Hewlett-Packard scandal and the techniques used by private investigators. Newhouse and Gibbons resume their internal investigation. And they employ a respected PI agency run by former federal agents to investigate the regional managers and assistant managers in those other two regional offices. And I'm pulling up this next slide, as part of the investigation, employees of the PI firm use pretexting, which, you know, I don't know why we've had to invent a term for that. They're just lying about who they are. And it's,
you mean like all the FBI agents do when they investigate us?
They use pretexting to obtain the phone records.
He likes that term.
Various managers and high-level officers. From these records and other interviews, the PIs discover that both the CEO and CFO were likely involved in funneling funds for the government bribes to these sales managers, and the PIs prepare a report explaining that to the general counsel. The questions that raises, again, are four in number, and Holly is remarkably capable of answering several of these. What are the potential legal and ethical problems with the pretexting? You know, from my perspective, it may well amount to either any kind of wire fraud or identity theft. Is it significant whether the attorneys knew about, ordered, or approved the pretexting? Is the memo the PIs prepared protected by the privilege? And what are the preferred practices to ensure that that report does remain privileged? And I'll turn that over to Alice and Holly.
Yeah, I think the ethical rules that are included in your slides make it pretty clear that if you, and it's a strange distinction, I think. I think if you, it's one of those things where if you hire a group and you don't know what they're doing, then you may not be responsible for it. But if you hire it and are even told, as we saw in the Hewlett-Packard situation, at a minimum, you can be charged with crimes. Apparently, they've now all dropped the charges, and a couple people pled to misdemeanors, I think. But
and that happened in the state case, but I think there's still a federal matter potentially pending.
That's right. The charges were ended up being dropped against the ex Hewlett-Packard chairwoman and a couple other people. But you know, certainly they were faced with felonies, and this could happen. And so, in addition to ethical obligations, there definitely are, whether they're in this case possibly politically motivated or not, lots of different other laws you're going to bump up against. And one of the things, Holly, in the ABA Model Rule 5.3, which is also in the South Carolina and I think North Carolina rules, if a non-lawyer is employed or retained by or associated by a lawyer having direct supervisory authority over the non-lawyer shall make reasonable efforts to make sure ensure that person's conduct is compatible with professional obligations of the lawyer. So I think the lawyer hiring a non-professional should make sure that they know what that non-lawyer is doing on their behalf and how they're doing it.
I agree, and I think that, you know, it does. I mean, Josh, I was teasing him a little bit about this earlier. It does seem a little bit odd, although, of course, you've got the federal government that's charged with, you know, enforcing the law and public safety and all that kind of stuff. And, of course, they're allowed to use all kinds of pretexting and that sort of thing. So I guess that's fair since they're the government and they're charged with the public safety. But it does seem, strike me as a little bit odd that the techniques that they're trained to use are the ones that, that lawyers can get in trouble for. But nonetheless, that is the case. And you'd be much, you know, much better served by not engaging in these techniques or trying to hire a firm to do indirectly what you cannot do directly. As to whether the report is privileged, I think it is, so long as the, you know, you make it clear that the law firm is hiring the consultant. I think that's true with any kind of consultant. You always want the law firm, not the company, to hire the third party and have that in writing so that you can better protect the work product. And that's probably the best practice right there.
And have them report directly to the lawyer with the results.
That's right.
Okay, we're coming on to the joint defense agreements, attorney's fees, and failure to discipline. We're going to run a few minutes over, but these are you know, good questions to get into. The grand jury subpoenas had also been issued to CEO Scott and the CFO. And each retained individual legal counsel, and Infotech agrees to pay for their attorney's fees as required by the written employment contracts of both individuals. So their rights are coming from written employment contracts. The attorneys enter into for all the entities, and the CEO and CFO enter to a written joint defense agreement. The joint defense agreement prohibits the disclosure of the existence of the agreement to those not party to the JDA and requires participants in the JDA to keep confidential any information shared pursuant to it. So in a second meeting with AUSA, there's considerable discussion about what, if anything, Infotech is doing in regards to executives and other employees who might have been involved in wrongdoing. She makes it clear to counsel that misconduct should not be rewarded and strongly implies that failing to terminate wrongdoers and or taking care of their attorney's fees will work against the company in her decision whether or not to prosecute. I know this sounds an awful lot like the Stein case, if you guys are familiar with that. After the investigative report is completed, Newhouse distributes copies of the report, including to the CFO and the CEO. And after a highly charged meeting of the board, in which the officers denied all wrongdoing, the CEO and CFO agree to take paid leaves of absence. And so we're coming to the first slide discusses what purposes did JDA serve? Are there legitimate reasons for the government to view them with disfavor? And does it matter whether they're written or verbal? So get thoughts on this.
From the government's perspective, as soon as you find out there's a JDA, it's sort of a, oh, because now this thing just got a year longer. It gets so much harder to deal with that on the front end, as corporate counsel, just keep in mind that regardless of the fact that they protect perfectly valid rights, they will muddy up the waters and make the resolution much more complex. We're running short on time, so let me get kind of to the key point about JDAs and the McNulty memo. There was recently a decision. Under Thompson, we as prosecutors could consider towards charging whether or not the company was a part of a JDA in providing information about the investigation to its employees against the company in the charging decision. We could also consider things like, were they still paying the attorney's fees for those potential, what we're going to conclude are wrongdoers. And we could also consider things like, you know, has the guy even gotten fired yet? Or is he, you know, on a paid leave of absence? Is he still in control of the company? The McNulty memo came down, and we can still take into account negatively if there's a JDA and you're sharing information with the targets of the investigation. We can still take into account if you have or haven't disciplined the employee, if they're still in charge. But something that has come up is the Stein decision out of New York, which is probably better known as the KPMG case. And it's bad facts. It's bad facts for the Justice Department, and it's an opinion that when you read it, is dripping with contempt for the prosecutors. And ultimately, that court, for better or for worse, found that under the Thompson memo, the AUSA's power to pressure KPMG to cut off the fees to their lawyers, to the defense lawyers of the accountants who counseled this scheme, that violated their Fifth and Sixth Amendment rights to counsel. Now, you know, people can definitely differ as to whether or not the Fifth and Sixth Amendment rights to counsel extends that far. If you could come up with a theoretical construct to defend that, the Stein decision certainly could, but I would tell you two things. That case is still in litigation today. I mean, they're still charged, but when you look at the opinion, you see two things that strike you. One is that they are talking about discovery from the government to the defendants of over 20 million documents. So this isn't like, you know, a small town private lawyer can handle this volume of discovery. It's going to take phenomenally capable corporate funding to pay for these lawyers. And they got it in that case. Because the other thing you'll see from the face of the opinion is where it says, you know, appearing for the defendants, it goes on for about three Westlaw screens just to lawyers. And
we love those cases.
Yeah, that was really what was at stake there. So
88 pages, I've read every page.
There will be, and there is, ample criticism of the department, and people say that, well, McNulty was really just a tactical retreat from the Thompson memorandum because they saw the Stein decision coming, and they knew that Arlen Specter has introduced a bill to change whether or not justice can consider paying for attorney's fees as a factor. But I can tell you from having worked close enough to the people tied to those decisions in justice for about a year, 2 years ago, that these things have been under consideration for quite some time.
The interesting thing about McNulty is, you know, obviously the government's always going to say, you know, look at all these concessions we've made, and then the defense bar is always going to say, it's not enough, it's not enough, it's not enough. And the truth probably lies somewhere in the between. But some of the odd things, at least that strike me, that the McNulty memo does in this regard is, you know, first of all, I'm sorry if joint defense agreements make you, you know, spend longer on your investigations, but that's what we call our job. And so, you know, sorry you have to do yours, but we have to do ours. And I just don't think that the existence of a joint defense agreement in and of itself should be a negative consideration. I think they're very necessary to us doing what you want us to do, which is to get to the bottom of what's happening. If people aren't going to share information with us and they're all lawyered up, which most smart executives are, we can't do what you want us to do. So I would say, you know, it's sort of a Jerry Maguire thing, help me to help you. Let me have my JDA. Now, I realize if people are using them to obstruct or to be obtuse or whatever, they can do that with or without a JDA, and that's something you should take into consideration. But I just don't think they're evil incarnate, and I never did even when I was a prosecutor. I think people react negatively to them because they've never seen them work in a positive way, or they don't recognize that they can. As to the attorney's fees, I think it's interesting. You know, you can no longer consider that under McNulty, where you could under Thompson, except in really rare circumstances where you think the attorney's fees are being used to obstruct the investigation. But you can still consider whether they've disciplined or fired somebody before they've been indicted or charged with anything. And so you might have the weird situation, but because of what the government can and can't do under McNulty, they can require you to fire somebody, but you still have to pay their attorney's fees.
Well, if
they have a contractual or state right to those attorney's fees.
Well,
so it's a little bit of an odd bird.
Holly, that's why I wanted to comment a little bit on KPMG, because under the facts of that case, I mean, first of all, KPMG had authority to indemnify and pay fees for their employees, but further than that, they had a longstanding policy of doing so without caps, and so the employees were standing there, as far as this decision is written, with a pretty solid expectation that they were going to have their legal fees paid for. So really, the KPMG case doesn't stand for the proposition that corporations now must pay their employees attorney's fees, period. But if through their bylaws, and the court in a footnote likens this to a contract implied in fact in the KPMG case, although there, you know, one of the written contracts, I think, for one of the defendants actually had that clause in it, but for the defendants that didn't have that protection, they certainly had could point to a longstanding policy where they expected and KPMG had in the past paid for attorney's fees. So it's not a case that says, you know, corporations out there, you have to, without regard to anything else, pay fees. But if there's a contract, a quasi-contract, statutes, bylaws, policies, something employee has a possible right to attorney's fees, that's where the KPMG...
Yeah, I mean, I think we could, I think the audience and us, if we had the time, we could talk about the Stein decision for like 2 hours and never come to any joint, you know, position on it. I think my personal reaction to the Stein decision is that prosecutor or prosecutors really made that judge mad. And so whatever they did, it didn't matter, you know, it didn't matter what the law was or what it wasn't, it didn't matter. I mean, to say that you have a contractual property right to rise the level of substantive due process because you had an expectation based on nothing in writing and no experience of your own, to me, is a little bit crazy. And I think most corporations should be like, holy moly, if I pay for one employee one time, I've got to pay for everybody now. You know, I think that's a little nuts. But I think the bottom line is some of the criticisms of Stein are a result of the fact that judge was obviously incensed with the heavy hand of the government in that case. And it sounds like, from some of the facts, justifiably so. That said, to be fair to Josh, I don't think that most prosecutors act like that. And I certainly don't think most prosecutors outside of the Southern District of New York act like that.
Well, Holly, one judge I don't want to incense is Judge Cox, who's ready for the next panel.
Okay.
And thank you for calling in and defending me on a number of occasions.
And insulting you and others. I try to mix it up.
Thank you so much, Holly. We appreciate it. We know you're on the road. And any questions before we go? We're out of time, but... we'll also be here after if you got questions.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me, and I hope you guys enjoy the rest of the panel.
Thank you very much.
A jelly thing.
Jelly fellow.
Take another break here.
Jim, y'all need a couple of minutes just to stretch. Let the audience stretch. About 5 minute stretch. And by the way, in case I forget it, following this next session, we're hosting a very light reception in the Birdman Lounge, which is you go down the hall at the other, you go down the faculty office row to the elevator, make a right, and go through that door. The Birdman Lounge is on your left back there. It's the faculty lounge. So all of you are welcome to join us.
Sorry.
I don't know what we did. Thank you very much. You know.
point. We're here for the last part of our conference. I'm very honored that the conference is being conducted this year, the third time it's been done, and I'm very grateful to Walter Cox and to the Nelson Mullins firm. I do want to reiterate that I'm not a white-collar criminal, but this topic is certainly a very important one. And today we're going to have a rather unusual perspective. The panel that I will introduce is going to be talking about things we have learned. And these three speakers, these three panelists, learn things in a quite different way than many people. Two of them learn them by being very prominent in their respective careers. One is a lawyer, one in the field of medicine and investment. And unfortunately, they then had a vacation, each of them, in a facility in the northern, about 20 miles north of here. It happened to be a federal correctional institution, was the FCI. And then in each instance, since being released, they have participated actively in various types of rehabilitation activities and seeking to render service. One of them, Jim Toms, who was a student of mine a few years ago, I guess about 35, and who had a really outstanding career as a lawyer, has been very helpful for me in trying to present programs and seminars for my students here at Duke to give them a better understanding of the realities of what's going on in the prison system and related matters. And I think largely due to Jim, I've been able to arrange tours that have taken me out to a place where the gentleman immediately to my left plays a major role. And I'm referring now to Art Beeler, who is the warden at the FCI at Butner. He is the senior warden in the Bureau of Prisons and has a tremendous amount of experience. He also is very interested in education. He has conducted various online courses and participated in activities designed to give people a better understanding of what's going on in the field of corrections. With respect to the middle speaker, the middle panelist, Earl Bryan, I should note that he was, I believe, the most decorated doctor who served in Vietnam in World War, the Vietnamese War. He is highly regarded as a surgeon, held a very high post at the state cabinet level in California under Governor Ronald Reagan. I think there were 55,000 people who were under his jurisdiction, and ironically, some of them were those who maintained the correction systems in California. So he learned it about corrections by being in top of the correctional system of a state and then by having opportunity to see the inside of a federal facility. I can't imagine a more diverse group and group of speakers that would have more to offer, and so I'm going to turn things over to them. Jim, I believe you're going to lead off, and we'll hear about things we have learned.
Thank you, Judge Everett. It's a special privilege to share, we hope, some practical and personal perspectives today with you. My background is based on 30 years of practice of the law, trials, appeals, legislative work, lobbying, governmental relations, and also the management of the major personal and professional crisis in my life, in which 12 years ago I revealed grave personal misconduct that resulted in my resignation from the bar and led ultimately to my serving a sentence in the federal prison system. In the intervening years, the intervening 5 years since my release, I have had the privilege of working with Judge Everett here at Duke, with many of the students, and have had the privilege of returning to work in a capacity assisting members of the bar. And for all of those opportunities, I'm most grateful. It would be first most important for me to tell you, to share with you, my former colleagues, my regret for the embarrassment that I caused my former profession by my misconduct, and to apologize to you for the harm that I caused the law and the profession that I had served well, I think, for many years. The second point I would make is that it is important to learn from the experiences we have, good and bad, to have useful lessons that may be of value to others, and that is the purpose of this ending session of the class today. None of us come with any particular claim of expertise. I think the perspective that I use is probably best expressed by the English theologian C.S. Lewis when he writes, "Think of me as a patient in the same hospital who, having been admitted a little longer, may have some useful advice." So today in this last section of the class, we will first consider ideas on handling trouble, should it come to you, or should it come to your clients, particularly focusing on the business and professional clients that you may encounter who become targets of the investigations that have been discussed earlier today. Secondly, strategic suggestions for you and your clients as you consider public perception of white-collar offenses and offenders. And thirdly, useful techniques to improve the professional relationship that you can have as counsel with the Federal Bureau of Prisons. There are really some things you can do that will make a difference, and a positive difference, for your people. First, just a few minutes about suggestions on handling trouble. The most unpalatable news is better faced than avoided. Secondly, when you're in the wrong, accept responsibility clearly and without windy excuses. Your friends don't need the excuses. Your critics will not be satisfied. Third, do and get your clients to do all they can do to remedy the harm they have caused. But recognize what can be fixed and when you must move on to other tasks. Next, recognize that each of us in trouble needs outside help to mend our broken lives, whether from a trained counselor, a pastor, priest, or rabbi, or simply from a good friend who can help us keep a realistic perspective of reality, where we are, and where we need to go. Remember that the good guy who first reported the Enron scandal ultimately took his life because he could not handle the change in self-esteem that came as that company collapsed around him. And I suggest that many of these individuals, given special help and resources, might be made useful and might be saved. Now let's take just a couple of minutes to look at the handout as we consider the second point of public perception. If you look at the first two pages after the top index page, the polling data I'm giving you, the first front and back, is 2002 data, but I suggest it's still current, and it reflects a perception on the part of the American public that the stiffer corporate crime penalties are still not tough enough from the perspective of the American public. Look on the back page and see that the American public trusts the company's executives where these individuals work, but distrusts the rest. My suggestion to you is that this tendency in the body politic leads us to the continued morality tales that we see played out in the press, in the trials that go on. And as the hour is late, I will not belabor the particular materials I've put in there for you to consider, but I have copied some press clips about the Conrad Black and David Stockman cases that are pending before us, and I suggest those are probably the most highly visible morality plays. Notice that in both cases, there are cooperating defendants who have pleaded who are testifying against the high-profile defendants in those events on stage. Then I called your attention the reported case, the Gormley case from the Fourth Circuit that appears immediately before the Conrad Black and Stockman articles as an illustration of how a lawyer should not handle trouble of his own. In this instance, the lawyer involved, who was a man that I met when he came to the Butner federal prison, basically did exactly the opposite thing he should have done when he saw trouble coming. First place, he was advising some scamsters who were basically operating a pyramid scheme using doctors' money and paying off the earlier investors with the later investors' money. But particularly, and if you look at deep in the opinion, there is an intriguing commentary by the court that sustained his conviction. Gormley was a self-proclaimed securities lawyer. He claimed to be an expert on investment programs, and then talks about how he had approved this particular scheme. The critical mistake he made is that when he was visited by an FBI agent who told him that his clients were scamsters, he protested that they were honest businessmen. And the lawyer's role changed at that point to being a target. And of course, he wound up charged with his clients and actually ultimately suffered a much greater penalty than the clients who got away with the money. You'll find the case, I think, instructive and helpful. The final substantive point I want to raise before turning the program over to my fellow panelists is to suggest some specific techniques that you need to be aware of for assisting a client who must serve a term of imprisonment to meet public perception, to promote respect for the law, or whatever combination of reasons. And that is to let you know that there are resources easily and publicly available to you. I've copied one section of the Program Statement Index. The program statements are the particular source of administrative law, and those are easily available. You'll see in the page I've copied the Bureau of Prisons website, and I've copied the section on program statements that deals particularly with inmate matters. These program statements can make a huge difference in both the adjustment of your client and particular issues that arise, all the way from custody classification, what level of facility this individual might go to the very interesting program, the drug abuse treatment program, which can result in a full year cut off the sentence that's awarded to this individual by the court. To give you a sense of how easy it is to research it, I've copied from the website the couple of pages from the drug abuse program manual statement that show how you qualify for that program and thus the 1 year reduction in sentence. And you can see how easy it is to do the research and to see that essentially, even if the individual does not have a documented drug history, If there is alcohol affected in the offense behavior or implicated in the offense behavior, it is quite possible, assuming that you can meet the burden of showing to the counselor at the Bureau of Prisons facility for this person to be admitted to the program and perhaps earn a full year off of their sentence. The final point I would make before turning the program over to Dr. Earl Bryan would be to simply show common courtesy and professionalism as you deal with the Bureau of Prisons officials. It is remarkable to me to see oftentimes how individuals dealing with this professional staff are ungracious or presumptuous or uncaring of the genuine security implications of their facilities. And there are just a lot of things you can do where you'll be a lot better received with recognition of the legitimate issues that they have before them. Now, the last pages of the handout deal with a very intriguing new program that Dr. Bryan will talk to you about as he gives some perspective on his background and interests that he and I are deeply involved in with Warden Beeler and under Judge Everett's leadership to improve the job training skills just now at the inmates, for the inmates at the Butner Correctional Complex in what has turned out to be a national program. It's valuable for you to know about it. You may have someone who will qualify for that, for the job training program that you represent. But perhaps more importantly, if you have a white collar defendant who is going to need to serve time, it will offer hope and meaning to their time of incarceration if they can be of constructive help in this program that may create some job opportunities for people who desperately need them to have hope and to have an opportunity to stay away from future criminal behavior. Thank you for this time today, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Earl Bryan.
Shall I just sit here? Well, as Jim pointed out, I also served time in federal prison, specifically at the same institution Jim was in. So we had a good time walking around the track every day talking to one another about world issues. Prior to that life, I graduated from Duke University Medical School, trained at Stanford University in neurological surgery, was leading a happy life when I ran into Ronald Reagan. I ultimately became Secretary of Health and Welfare for the state of California, which meant I was on top of the prison system. I managed a system, a correctional system, with about 35,000 inmates and dealt with these issues, welfare issues, health issues, and employment issues every day of the week. I had extensive conversations with Ronald Reagan about issues for the next years of his life and dealt with those particular issues, and was a strong believer in all of the principles you heard the U.S. attorney talk about here today and that are espoused regularly about things like rules of law, innocent till proved guilty. Believed in that very firmly. So when I was ultimately in trouble for covering up a bank fraud, which didn't exist, I thought certainly this will go away. I spent $3.5 million of my own money hiring excellent lawyers, and they were excellent, and we got nowhere. I was convicted, and I was sentenced to 5 years in federal prison. So what I've got to report to you about is the fact that this is about managing expectations of people. People don't understand, particularly people in the white-collar crime, as smart as they may be at what else they do. And I was a professor in the medical school, and I was a successful business person and made a lot of money. And everything I did was generally successful, but I did not fully understand that there is a nexus between the issue of the public attitude towards crime and punishment and public safety and that exists in the gradient by the federal government in particular and state governments that are large to a second degree, of the intent to do something about this to satisfy their constituency. The net effect is you're going to be confronted, or you are confronted, I'm not sure what your level of practice is, with the fact that many people like me and others are going to go to prison whether they like it or not. And they're going to be mad about it. And they're going to tend to want to act out in these institutions. And I can tell you up and down the line, in my own experience, the most even-minded, fair-minded people I encountered in the entire system were in the prison system. They actually were consciously concerned about the well-being of the people. There's some nuts there. There's some people that shouldn't be there who are Machiavellian and are mechanistic and are brutal. But by and large, people like Art Beeler and his predecessor out of Butner were very fine people with whom you would want to associate in other walks of life. Jim has pointed out to you the fact that there are programs available. I saw a woeful lack of any understanding of these programs by the lawyers that were coming in to see inmates. Not surprisingly, I was frequently asked by inmates at the Butner Low facility to discuss their health care problems with them. I was prohibited from practicing medicine, which, of course, I didn't want to do anyway, but I was perfectly willing to tell them what I knew about the subject, and it ultimately got around to what their personal problems were. And what I found over a period of time was essentially in this country, in the federal system in particular, because that's the only place I've been, although I was in charge of the state system, we are putting people into warehouses and we're forgetting them. And we're taking the attitude that they are essentially cultural outcasts who have no future purpose. Now, I used to own United Press International. I was the chairman of it. I started a couple of television networks that were successful. So I've had some access to some people in other parts of the world who worry about these things. And I was particularly interested in a few Dutch Supreme Court justices that I met who said, we have the attitude in this country that ultimately these people are going to come back. They're going to get out. They're going to go move into society. Now, it doesn't take a genius to figure out that if a person, for example, in the classic case here, because it represents 85% of the convictions, a drug dealer was making $200,000 a year cash, riding around his neighborhood in an expensive car, and you put him into a prison which costs something like $40,000 or $50,000 a year to keep him, and then you move him into an environment where he's going to work at McDonald's flipping burgers, to understand quickly that his level of income has come down so much he's going to resort back to his antisocial behavior. So Jim pointed out that Art Beeler, who is the head warden in the whole system, Greg Forrest, who is the chief probation officer for the Western North Carolina, Jim Toms and I and Judge Everett and a couple of other people have gotten together and created a foundation called the 4R Foundation. That stands for Reduce Recidivism and Restore Relationships. We have a very simple goal in mind. We know people are going to prison. There were 750,000 people put in prison last year. 650,000 got out, and that's going to continue for the foreseeable future. So what do you do for those people? Well, one of the things you can do is figure out before they go in what it is they're capable of doing when they get out. You can put that in the pre-sentence investigation report. I defy you now to find anything about a skills assessment or where these people might be trained. Then you can have the prison system, when they get in the system, train them to do something. Art Beeler is now working on programs at Butner that were essentially stopped. Now, when I was Secretary of Health and Welfare in California, we had a host of programs for educating and training these criminals, and these criminals were the hardcore type. They were people who had been out and done very rough things to people, not white-collar criminals, but they were still trainable. And they would burn out of their antisocial behavior, usually about age 30, and we knew we could do something with it that was productive, and we had pretty good control on that and pretty good results and much lower recidivism. So it occurred to me in walking around the track at Butner many times every day with Jim that essentially if we paid attention to the well-being of these people post-incarceration and trained them to do something where they could go into a job and not make $7.50 an hour, which nobody can live on, but get a decent wage, be able to get health insurance, end up with the ability to move up in their jobs like anybody else does, that they would probably reduce the recidivism, right? So that's what this foundation is in the process of trying to do. not directly provide those services. We want to do things to encourage the Bureau of Prisons, which Art will tell you about, to do more training program, to encourage the probation departments on the pre-sentence side to do these assessments before they get in there, and to then on the post-sentencing, on the post-incarceration side, help these people get jobs and help employers find these people. We did a little bit of this at Butner, and you would be amazed how it worked. We had a job fair there. We took each person that was willing to mentor, took three inmates and said, let's teach you how to do a resume. Let's teach you how to do a job interview. And I think we ended up with about 15 local employers who came out and had a job fair. And they all got hired. I don't know how well they're doing because I had no way of keeping up with it. But I know from the point of view of what to do for this society, these people are with us. There are 15 million people out there affected by all this. They need help.
Sentencing services that would basically do a lot of what you're talking about, but rather than doing it while people were incarcerated, would do testing, would then work with individuals if they needed education, if they needed job skills, if they needed to learn how to use computers, do resumes, whatever. As an alternative sentence, doing that within the community, and it was cheaper than paying what is paid every day to put somebody in jail, whether you're teaching them or not. And
well, the public attitude now.
Well, the public attitude is exactly
lock them up
what you just
and
said.
Throw away the key.
Yeah.
That has evolved. When I was in charge of the prison system in California, it was a lot more rehabilitative than it was, and that came under criticism because, rightfully so in a lot of ways, because they were destroying society's fabric. That's the bottom line to it. So somebody wanted something done about that. Now, interestingly, Ronald Reagan had a sign over his door. You heard about a quote of Ronald Reagan had a sign over his office door that said, obey the rules or get out. He also, in lengthy discussions with me, said to me, you know, the government will indict a ham sandwich if it wants to. So we don't trust them either. The question is how to get a balance in this thing. And one thing is for sure, whether you've got it balanced at the front end or whether you're training people to avoid prison in the first place, the fact of the matter remains they're still with us. They're alive, they're out there, and they're going to go back in at the rate of something like 70%, depending on how you look at it. But over the next 3 years, something like two-thirds of the people are going to go back into prison. And you want to know something amazing? For many of them, I watched them come back in. This was like going on R&R. This facility that these facilities he runs out there, are absolutely beautiful places. They're as nice as the campus we have up here at Duke University. The only problem, they've got a fence around them, and the food's not that good. But it's a better life than being on the outside, living in a halfway house, which is a dump with rats running around in it, and being exploited in the neighborhood by some menial job that they're going to kick you out of as soon as you're out of. So they would rather be back in prison, many of them. And that's a shame, you know? And it's because we've discarded them. We've got to stop doing that.
It's in our pecuniary best interest as a society, apart from the moral question, to deal with this in a positive way for those who want to change.
Well, where I was going with what I was saying is that it absolutely amazed me. I'm the chair of Buncombe Alternatives, which used to have a sentencing services program that was used quite a bit because we had good people in it. But unfortunately, we didn't have the numbers. And the whole reason for why we needed that program and why we need the programs that you're advocating is that the one thing people forget is these people do come back out. And many times, if anybody thinks about it long enough, they'll realize that they know somebody's father, brother, sister, mother, daughter who was in the prison system or has been charged with something, rightly or wrongly. And rather than just tossing them into the local facility or any facility for however long, if they could get either the drug rehabilitation that they need, which in many respects I believe the the numbers that show the prisons are becoming more of a warehouse for drug addicts as opposed to those that are actually selling it is phenomenal. But we also have people, or we can't build enough prisons quickly enough. We also, as you were saying, people get out in less time than what their original sentence was. And many times that's because we don't have the places to warehouse them. And if we don't enroll not just ourselves but the public in the fact that these people are coming out and we need to be prepared and we need to prepare them for it, all we're doing is perpetuating an ongoing.
Well, this is where it starts, because for many of these people, the only person they have that is a near friend with any kind of connection to any sort of situation is their lawyer. It may even be a public defender who is underpaid and overworked and not the smartest card in the deck. But if he goes out there, or she goes out there, and knows what services are available and visits with these prisoners, they'll find that a lot of them have talent and gifts. And I got to tell you, Art Beeler, he was not my warden, but I've been to his facility. And every prisoner in there knows him. Mm-hmm. Every one of them respects him, because he treats them in a fair-handed manner. He doesn't tolerate anybody else beating up on them. And if there's opportunity for him, he's going to grant it. The truth of the matter is, it's just too little opportunity. This cycle can be stopped. I'm not sure we're going to get around in our lifetimes to any sort of new technique for diverting them before they ever get there. We're not that enlightened. But if we can keep them from going back, we can stop this process. And the way to keep them from going back, in our perspective, is get them meaningful employment and dignity.
Art, why don't you tell us about the detail about what the BOP is doing and in this pilot project?
Be glad to, Jim, and thank you for inviting me, and thank you for listening to all three of us. You know, it's unique for a warden to be sitting between two people who are convicted felons, ex-felons. We have grown into a deep friendship over the last couple of years, because we've been working on a project that we believed very deeply in and very strongly in, and that is providing opportunities for people to reduce recidivism. When you talk about public policy, and when you talk about public policy at the heart of public policy, and you talk about the things that we're talking about, you're talking about reducing the recidivism of people who are doing time in prison. And we're not talking typically about white-collar offenders right now, because white-collar offenders typically have money. They typically have a family. They don't typically lose either one, although in some cases they do. What we're talking about is the 80% of the population that aren't white-collar offenders, that end up coming into our facilities for a various sundry of criminality. And I'm not a lawyer. I'm a correctional administrator, so I won't even go that route. But we deal with lots of different kinds of folks from all different social economic strata. The essence of what Earl talked about earlier, though, is very true. Is if you have a drug dealer who is making $200,000 riding around in his Lexus in downtown whatever, and all of a sudden he ends up going to McDonald's while he's at the halfway house making $7.50 an hour, and he will work at McDonald's while he's at the halfway house because it's a requirement to work at the halfway house. But what ultimately happens is the day that he leaves the halfway house, he quits the job at McDonald's because he no longer has that obligation to work at the halfway house. And the probation service is sitting there saying, okay, you got to find another job. Greg Forrest and I have a difference of opinion about one thing, and that is I say that we've got about 90 days to capture the person before they get back into a cycle. Greg says 120 days. So we've split it, and now both of us say 110 days. It's really academic what the situation is. We have a very short window of time and opportunity to provide these people some hope, other than the hope of $200,000 drug dealing kind of folks that are on the street. I would like to think that most of them, and I can tell you that most of them don't make $200,000. Most of them are doing other things. That said, I see this as a public safety issue in public policy as much as I see it as a pecuniary issue of public policy. And the public safety issue is simply this. If we can find some ways of keeping folks meaningfully employed in the community at a livable wage other than $7.50 an hour, and if we can find some way of doing that, we increase the public safety, because the people are not out there robbing grandmama, swiping the purses, doing the criminality that's out there happening with people who are out there reverting the criminality because that's what they are doing to gain their income. There's lots of academic research on this regarding how many crimes is done by a criminal prior to being convicted, prior to being arrested. I won't go into those things, but if either half of those things are true, we spend a lot of resources as a country, not so much in the criminal prosecution. We spend a lot of resources in the insurance industry, in the healthcare industry, and all those other industries from people who are robbing and stealing and making other people's lives miserable. So from my perspective, this program is not only a pecuniary issue, it's not only a rehabilitative issue, it's a public safety issue. And, you know, when Greg and I go out and sell this, we sell it as a public safety issue, because that's what the public typically wants to hear. You know, the public typically wants to hear, make little rocks from big rocks. So we sell this, and we firmly believe in all these things, but we sell this as a public safety issue because it has real public safety perspectives on that. Now, Jim asked me also to speak on a couple of things from a perspective of an employee in the Bureau of Prisons and how to come to an institution should you be a lawyer. And I'll be happy to do that. One of the things that everybody needs to know is that there are different levels of institutions. There's minimum security institutions to maximum security institutions to a facility like mine, which is an administrative facility, one of my facilities. I'm now responsible for 5 facilities at the Butner Complex. I'm now the complex warden. So I have 5 facilities underneath my supervision. But each one of those institutions is different. If you come to the medical center, which is the administrative facility, remember that we house all different administrative levels of offenders, from minimum security inmates to maximum security inmates, to include terrorists. And so our security is a little different. And what I tell everybody is 9/11 has changed the world. And 9/11 has changed the world as far as prisons are concerned, too. And that is even getting inside of an institution. So my best advice to anybody who wants to come visit a client in a prison is please pick up the phone and contact the unit staff of that institution and say, I want to visit my client. If you wish to bring a notepad, because the correctional officer who's on the desk, if you come as a regular visitor, the correctional officer on the desk is told nobody takes anything in, nor anything out. So if you come and you want to present some documents to your client, or you want to have a notepad, which is all reasonable, very reasonable, ask. I will tell you also, as far as the Bureau of Prisons is concerned, if you by some chance can't get somebody on the telephone, our web addresses are sitting on the web page. I get emails every day from people saying, please let me do X, or please let me do Y. Now, I don't answer them all, I will be honest with you, I send them to staff, but that web page is there. That's probably the best advice I can give anybody coming to site to visit a prison. The other thing I can tell you, if the correctional officer who is doing the best of their ability to do their job says no to somebody, please don't get in a confrontation with that correctional officer. They're just trying to do their job. If you've got a gripe or a complaint, go ahead and comply with the correctional officer and then send it to me or one person like me, because we'll resolve it and we will try to factor that in, and then if we need to, we will try to teach the correctional officer the right way to do it. Most of the correctional staff are just wonderful people, and I say most. You know, they are in a tough position, trying to do a tough job. Just imagine yourself at a front lobby desk in a prison where you have everybody trying to come to see people. You've got very strict security requirements. You've got a magnetometer that you've got to run everything through. And somebody starts being unprofessional. I'll just keep it that clean, okay? Because the correctional officer says no to something. Well, the moment that person becomes unprofessional, the correctional officer will simply just say, you're not on my list anymore. Goodbye. Never know mine. Bye. And, you know, because they got 15 other people all around them trying to get in. So I can understand that. I was a correctional officer. I had to post at that front desk. I processed those 450 visitors a day trying to get inside of an institution. And I've had those other situations occur. So I simply say, if in question, please don't get into a confrontation with the staff. If the staff is wrong, we will remedy it. Just pick up the phone and tell us. The other thing is, if you have special requests, please make those known ahead of time. If you need to be recording devices inside of an institution, don't just show up with a tape recorder, because probably nobody's going to let you in with a tape recorder. And that includes law enforcement, right, Josh? I'm not saying anything I don't say to assistant U.S. attorneys at the same time.
Me either.
That's right. Because I tell assistant United States attorneys, if you have special requests, let us know about them. We will try to facilitate them. But just don't show up at the front desk thinking that just because you're an attorney or just because you're an assistant U.S. attorney that somebody's going to pay you the mind of day. Because the folk, and that's not being negative, it's just those folks have a very tough job to do, that they're doing a lot of other things. Hopefully I answered those questions that you wanted me to answer on that, Jim.
You did, Art, and we've got about 4 minutes, so let's get some reaction. Yes, sir.
Yeah, Warden, what you're doing with these fellows, is that encouraged by Bureau of Prisons?
The director is very much encouraging this, and yes, the answer is yes. You know, the public policy of rehabilitation never left prisons. We kind of hid it because we had to, but it's never left prison. We've always been about rehabilitation to a degree. We called it habilitation and we called it programming. But you know, when Markison came out in 1974 in his article, public interest article, saying nothing works, and he was right in writing that article, and I'll be the first one to say that, because a lot of things didn't work. But he came back in 1979 and said some things do work. What we have to do is concentrate on those things that do work. Nobody listened to him the second time. What we've had to do is focus on those things that do work. And what we're trying to do is focus on those things that do work. You know, there's some things that work. Vocational training works. Having people have saleable job skills works. 39% less to recidivate if they have a saleable job skill. Working in getting a high school education works. Not nearly as much as a saleable job skill, but it works, 14%. Having drug abuse treatment works. Good drug abuse treatment. And I mean residential, long-term drug abuse treatment with aftercare that's linked to the community works. So we've had and this is what we now call evidence-based corrections. And we're spending a lot of time trying to make sure we do things that are evidence-based versus just the fly-in-the-wool kind of program that comes up. You know, that somebody says, oh, wow, isn't this wonderful? We have to buy into some of those because of political issues. I will give you one of those that I will talk about, and there's lots of discussion on this. Boot camps don't work. Okay? They have no aspects of reducing recidivism. The literature is clear on that. However, Congress liked boot camps. So for a little while, we ran a boot camp. We no longer run boot camps because we gathered the evidence and we told them this doesn't work. Now, there's some congressmen that probably aren't very happy with that because they liked them. But Our director is very, very committed that we chase things that are evidence-based and outcome-resulted. He's very strong on that. I'll give you his level of commitment. We had an offender workforce developments conference in Charlotte 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago?
Yes.
2 weeks ago. There was a double-edged sword happening. The director sent somebody from every institution to go to the conference. And the conference is talking about just what we're talking about right now. The double-edged sword is everybody wants to replicate something that we're trying to get started. But the director is that committed. And to think about in this budget time while we were still under a continuing resolution to send 114 people to a conference, that tells me what kind of commitment the director has.
Judge Everett?
Didn't you get some heat at one time about the Unicor program? Some people in Congress said retraining these prisoners is taking jobs away from Americans or something.
We continually get heat over the Unicor program. It's not just now, just wasn't then, it's now. There are always efforts from certain congressional districts because they see the jobs being taken by inmates they think could be taken by law-abiding citizens. Quite frankly and quite honestly, we don't want to take the jobs that law-abiding citizens can have. The jobs that our inmates do, what most of the time, law-abiding citizens aren't doing them anyway. Let's talk about textiles. We have textile factories. Anybody want to tell me what has happened to the textile industry in the United States? Most textiles have gone overseas and have been outsourced. But we still have that contingent saying we should not be having inmates work in textiles because they're taking jobs of Americans. Several of us have said, show us. Please point out to us the jobs that we're taking from Americans and we'll leave. There are other examples. The textile example is the most relevant one for right now. The furniture example is there also. The electronics example is there. We have moved significantly away from manufacturing, as has the United States economy. We're moving more to a service entity, industries focused, and quite frankly, a large part of this is due to the issues we've had with the manufacturer companies saying, you're taking jobs. So we're doing some stuff like now, like call centers. Do you realize that if you make a call to 411, many times on that opposite end of that call, you're going to have an Indian citizen or an inmate. The Indian citizen is, I'm not talking about an American Indian, I'm talking about from Bangalore, India, who speaks very good English, and they're running a computer program to do call 411 assistance. You pick up your cell phone, you call Sprint. That's not run by an American company, folks. Their 411 is going overseas, outsourcing. So we've now entered some agreements with call centers to say, let's let inmates do that. There's lots of security issues, and I can profit all those, but those are the kinds of things we're looking at doing now. So those are just some examples.
Yes, sir.
I used to work for the Bloomberg administration addressing employment issues, and see that it's pretty good vocational training program, which is attended by a lot of ex-prisoners. But the problem we ran into a lot was just that people who came out of prison, like they had such a black mark on their resume, a lot of them were seen to be unhirable. And those struck me, it just seemed so wrong that, you know, they served their time, and then for years after their release, you know, they couldn't even get jobs that they were overqualified for. And, you know, it's typical that, like, you can't ask someone during an employee interview in a lot of states about if they're married or if they have children, but you can ask them about what their criminal record is. And I'm just like to hear your thoughts on that. If you think that's, I don't expect it to change anytime soon. But
it's probably not going to change, and I don't foresee it to change. But one thing that is changing to some degree, and one thing that we're seeing the change, and one thing that everybody in this room can help us with, if you would like to, is that we now have some employers out there who understand that they need the workforce, and that the workforce we're sending out to them, if we train them and teach them, are good workers. You know, phenomena is happening in this country that the middle class is shrinking, and it's shrinking quite dramatically, fairly quickly. And so the workforce for, and I'm going to use an auto mechanic shop as an example. There's an auto mechanic company that shall remain nameless right now that needs 2,000 technicians a year. They can't find technicians because people in this country have gotten to the point that they don't want to have work as technicians. They want to be service providers or other folks. So they've got 2,000 technicians. Well, how about if we can find them 500 of those technicians through a job training program that happens inside of the institution and links them to a job? That's what our program's trying to do. We're trying to take people with skills, teach them those skills while in prison, have an apprenticeship program that gives them those journeyman skills, and then link them to a community resource. All of that is doable, and all of that's workable. The community resource is the tough part. We've got to find employers who are willing to do that. And there's lots of incentives for employers to do that, folks. The Workforce Investment Act will pay half of a salary for the first year for somebody to be working. There's tax incentives. But oftentimes, the employer doesn't want to do that. That's the bridge we've got to do. The bridge is not, I will tell you, the bridge isn't prisons. The bridge isn't the probation service. We want people to succeed. We don't need the job security. Josh, we don't need the, I mean, even with Josh up there, we don't need the job security because we have plenty of clients coming our way. What we need is the ability to keep the public safe by keeping people in the community working. That employer piece is so important, and it's the hardest nut to crack. I will be very honest with you. It's the hardest nut to crack, but it's not going to go away, so we're just going to keep on plugging.
But they are out there.
Yes, they are.
So one of the programs he's talking about is to get the probation people to take the attitude of finding those employers who have this enlightened attitude and then referring their clients to them, rather their ex-cons to them, rather than telling the former inmate, if you don't have a job, you're going back to prison. It's changing attitude. So part of this foundation approach is to try to train those. That's why Greg Forrest and what's the fellow's name from Missouri?
Doug Burris
have taken a leadership role in this, and they're changing the complexion of the people that are working for them, who have attitudes about trying to make this work rather than sending them back to prison.
You'll see Greg and Doug's, one of their articles in the handout that I think will be helpful if you're interested in pursuing that further. Thank you, Judge.
Thank you.
With my longtime friend Judge Everett and Duke Law School and Nelson Mullin, thank all of you for coming. I hope we can do it again in the future. But you can't do these things without volunteers like Judge Horn and my law partners and Alice and these guys. So thank all of you.